Hiyo! How's it going, everybody? Welcome to the Toby Wayne Show, and today's a good day. I got David Batman 1980 in the house with me here. He's moderating this sucker, so hope everybody's having a good day. I know I am. Today I think I'm going to be working on this Rhino bust, so I know I've got Cherry City Comic Con coming up. April 30th? And through the 31st, I think it is. So, looks like we're having a little difficulty here. Are we working? Are we
going? It says it's going. I'm not seeing it on my app here.
Well,
so there could be a delay. I'm not sure. It's very odd.
Don't know.
Because it's not showing live on your channel here either.
Oh, really?
So go to your briefly go over to your Chrome, to your dashboard, and it'll show you on the dashboard when you click here if it's live.
Where am I supposed to
right
go?
There that tab.
Yeah, it says it's live. No, yeah, maybe.
Is that right now?
That's that's what it's showing. I think that's right. Anyway, sorry about that, folks. I hate starting out these streams and looking like a jackass, but I guess that kind of
very odd. It's
comes with the
app. There it is.
Okay, very good.
Really delayed because now it's still showing.
Wow,
your start screen. There it is.
Okay, well, thank you guys very much for joining us today. We're getting off to a rocky start, as every single episode of the Toby Wayne Show is done, which hopefully we get our bugs worked out here. How am I supposed to clear my channel again here? Is it this little
forward slash clear?
Well, there's a setting in there, too, that allows me to clear it.
Yeah, you do that.
Yeah, anyway. Sorry about that, folks. Just clearing my chat. So anyway, yes, we are going to be working on this Rhino bust. It's a pretty good sized piece. I'm not really sure what the total overall dimensions are, but it's, you know, way bigger than my fist here. So let's, and I'm really close, really, really close to getting this thing finished. Rhino's always been one of my favorites, so we're gonna, and I've done a couple different busts of Rhino, but this one is gonna be the one that actually gets molded and cast, and, because he is so big, I'm gonna be doing a slush cast on him, so, you can see kind of on the underside here where I've got my finish line of where, the resin's gonna go to, do the slush, and then it'll be a hollow cast, and then we'll just put it on a base, and then that way it's not a solid chunk of resin, which could be incredibly very nice. David Batman 1980 is hosting the show. That's always exciting. Thank you very much, David. Appreciate
it. Absolutely
that.
Welcome.
Yes, yes. in the studio with me. So
that's right.
And of course, my better half, Katie, is not going to be joining us today. She's actually swimming, so she's got a swimming class that she's going to. So good luck with that, Katie, if you ever see this. Appreciate you being there as a moderator as well. I think it was last time we did a show, I fired her 4 times. So you're fired. But that's okay.
And that may not even be the record.
Yeah, that's not even the record. So we'll see what happens. We'll see what happens, but yeah, so anyway, hope everybody's day's going good. This is a kind of a short notice stream, but I had David here, and I had the time, so I figured, what the heck, let's do this. Let's bring it to the Twitch. So lots and lots of detail on this piece. A lot of detail. Detailed pieces like this definitely take its time to complete, but more detail the better. And I'm such a detail freak to begin with, so I'm a glutton for punishment, I guess. So
when do you think you actually started this?
It's
been quite a while.
Yeah, well, that's the unfortunate thing with just about every piece that I do. I start it all gung ho and I'm all fired up to get it done, and then
Because I remember when it was kind of just a sketch that you were working on, and it just slowly formed and got bigger and bigger. Because I remember the head was just like a little piece you had in the chair in there, and then it kept getting bigger.
I don't know. It's been a long time, actually. I think it's been several months, close to a year
Yeah, I
almost,
would
I
guess
would
probably
think.
longer than that. At least the face. Because the face started and then it kind of sat for a while and then it developed into the full size.
You just kind of, it kind of snowballs into a bigger and bigger piece as the time goes by. 'Cause you know what I find funny? You know what I find interesting is, you know, there could be tons and tons of detail packed into a piece, and I think people want more bang for their buck. And so if you have a bust that's, you know, a smaller piece, even though it's still tons and tons of detail, they don't, a lot of times I don't think people get what actually goes into these, like time-wise. You know, it doesn't matter this, I mean, I guess it does matter if the size is huge and then you're doing tons of detail, but you know, people want more bang for their buck, so
But even those small ones, you put in as much effort into every step of the way. So it's not like, the work for you is the same whether it's a small piece or a large piece for the most part. And so I think when people see a small piece, they don't see that value. Whereas if they have something that's a larger, fills their perspective, a little bit bigger when they're looking at it, it always looks more impressive to have something larger.
Oh yeah, the 1:1 scale Deadpool, the bigger, you know, of course that sucker. I mean, obviously because he's Deadpool, that draws people in at shows, but because of just the sheer size of this thing, I mean, people can see it. You can see him, you know, then they come
From a
right, you can
distance.
watch him for clear across the showroom floor and they come hightailing it over, especially the ones that are dressed up as
Well,
Deadpool.
yeah, with as many cosplayers that are out there, I mean, that bust like just disappears in the crowd of them when they're standing around
Oh
too. So you
yeah.
see it and it's like, oh, there's another Deadpool guy.
Yep.
But like that first year, there weren't as many Deadpool costumers
Yeah.
when you brought it out.
Yep.
And now there's so many.
Yeah. Yeah,
Especially with the
it's
movie.
yeah, no kidding. But yeah, that's it's pretty crazy.
But yeah, now's the time to get those going.
Oh, I
Have
know.
a nice painted one up for the next show. And
Yep.
yeah.
I think what I ought to do is just quit my day job,
How
and then I can just focus on
long have we been talking about that?
a long
A long
time,
time.
a very, very long time. Hey, it's gonna happen sooner than later, man. It'll happen sooner than later. We'll see. It'll
We have
work.
days like today all the time with even more productivity.
Well, yeah.
Since today is kind of a vacation day.
Today has been a fun day. Not it. Nobody's really gonna know. Although somebody on Instagram did mention it. Today's my birthday, of course. So I was able to get the day off, and then of course to have you come down has been awesome.
Yeah, it was
I've
fun.
loved having you. We met up in Salem there and had the spaghetti warehouse,
Yeah, that was
and
good.
yep, and lasagna and spaghetti, and then we came back to the house and I stayed up till a whopping 10
Yeah,
o'clock last night.
I sleep earlier than usual.
I'm telling you, man, you sit in that lazy boy chair and that is the end. That is the beginning of the end. But
There you got a little birthday message.
oh, hey now, Travis the Overlord. Did you see the notification, Travis? Or did it was it the text that I sent you that gave it away? I'm hoping that you got a notification, but we'll I'm hoping. But we'll see.
Got party of three going on
A party of three.
right
That's the best. That's all. That's
now.
talented group of
Nope.
individuals. You did not get the
Nope, the one
notification.
or the other. We don't know which one. You just said nope.
No.
Oh, yeah,
I
it
think
was
it
the
was.
text.
Yeah, it was the text. Dang it. Well, we'll just have to look into that. So, who knows? Who knows?
I get notifications on one channel, and it always tells me I've disabled the other somehow. But I have never enabled anything. So I got to look into those settings too,
Weird.
get a better idea of how it works.
Yeah, I don't know what the deal is. That's pretty sucky because I've got people that, you know, show up, so I know that they're getting notifications, but as far as...
Yeah, because it has, like, broadcaster options, so it has follow, live notifications, and a share button.
Yeah.
And at least for years, I have them all checked on, but I don't get them either.
Really?
For your channel, yeah.
It's
but I don't
conspiracy.
Get them for anything but one channel, and I follow, like, 50 channels now.
Really?
And I only get notifications for one. So I need to go in through and figure out where those settings are.
Hmm. I don't think I like that at all. I do not like that at all. So...
I think there's like an override setting that you can put in your dashboard
mm-hmm.
that turns them all off by default, no matter what the individual channel settings are.
Hmm.
So that may be what it is.
Could be. Could be. Well. Anyway, thanks for joining the Toby Wayne Show. I'm out. Travis, thanks for joining us. David Batman 1980. Thanks a ton.
Pleasure.
And we'll see you next week. Sometimes that's the way
your
I feel.
Your record, 9 minute.
Yeah, jeez, has it been 9 minutes already?
Yeah.
I need to get that timer set up where it tells
yeah.
me. I still don't have my bot set up yet.
One of those little chat timers or the chess timers.
Yeah, ding. Yeah.
Yeah, I put one on mine, but then I can never see mine when I'm actually playing pinball or something, so it's hard to actually know. That's how I end up getting on those 7 hour streams.
Yeah. Yeah,
like I've been playing for over 3 hours,
man,
and all of a sudden, boom, it's seven.
I couldn't even imagine. Oh, I mean, I guess
yeah.
I can imagine.
Well, like our
it,
6 hour stream we did on that first one.
Yeah, that's
it
true.
Went fast.
Yeah, that's
six
true.
6 hours is a pretty good amount of time.
That is a long stream.
Come on, Bucko. Don't you
oh,
want a
balloon? Thank you so
nice.
Much for the follow. I appreciate it. I hope you are having a good day, and I hope you learned something here today. If not, then it's all good. Thank you for tuning in and. Feel free to jump in the chat if you feel chatty. So, just working on this Rhino bust. Rhino's one of my favorite characters, and I've got a show coming up, so I've got a. I'd like to get him done by then, but we'll see. That might be a whole stream, of course, all just by itself.
Yeah.
Just the total.
Well, we could do the whole mold. So we talked about that too. Is,
yeah.
Is doing the whole molding process.
Yep.
And then while we're waiting for layers to cure, we can just be talking or working on something else.
Yeah.
That'd
and
be
now
kind of
that
a
would be that would
start
be
early
a,
on a Saturday and just go all
yep,
day until
that,
it's done.
That would be a long stream.
Yep.
That would be one definitely a long stream.
Yep.
So.
But that would be fun.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And people I think enjoy seeing the processes
yeah.
of how we get from point A to point B. But
plus the longer you go, that's where it starts stacking, like more people start viewing
yeah.
and then
agreed.
The channel starts moving up in the ranks a little bit with more viewers.
Yep.
So by the time we're done, that seems to be the way it always goes. By the time you're ready to wrap up a stream, then
yep.
you have all your viewers there.
Yep. There's a
but
way
that
we
would
can...
be good. And,
yeah.
And that's when you could promote ahead of time on social media and stuff too to say, hey, we're going to be molding this up.
Yep.
And then put a specific time out there to start and just let them know, hey, we're going all day.
Yep.
And let people drop in.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll have to do that on probably the next day you get a full day that you can
yeah.
go.
I would guess it's going to be at least a week. A little over a week.
Yep.
Before the first weekend that I get back.
Because, and I'm very happy for you, David is going to WrestleMania. He's going
to Texas.
Flying to Texas.
That's right. To have some good Texas barbecue.
Yeah, the real Texas barbecue.
That's going to be fun, though.
Yeah. That would be pretty cool. But.
And then to wrap up the whole weekend, we get to see Jim Ross right after Raw on Monday.
Oh,
so
cool.
We're going to the Jim Ross show immediately following Raw.
Oh,
a lot of fun.
Awesome.
Because we missed out on that last year.
Yep.
He did like 4 shows, but the tickets didn't go on sale till like we already had tickets for every event, so it wasn't possible to go see him. But this time I figured, all right, we're going to do it. And when you put one show at the end of Raw, it's like, that's the best time.
Yep.
Because then you can talk about the whole weekend.
Good old JR.
Oh, God, I'm going to talk about wrestling.
Good God in heaven.
And we're going to have a Hell in a Cell with potentially another crazy, crazy spot.
Yep.
Doubtful it'll be as crazy as Mick Foley, but...
Nope, you never know.
Yep.
Never
it'll be interesting.
Know. Boy, this thing weighs a ton, because
yeah.
it's solid. It's solid Gervont clay.
Yeah, you don't have, like, any, you know, filler inside
no.
or anything.
No, if I was smart, I think I would have done a tin foil
yeah.
filler, you know?
Yep.
It would have made things just a touch easier to hang on to this thing, but... Ugh, it's it is a beast.
So. That's good though.
Yeah, well, yeah.
I mean, this would be kind of a fun one to have that weight to it, that because you're doing the holocast with them.
Yeah.
But it might be a fun one to actually do the holocast, but then fill it with like the ball bearings or something, and then seal it off.
Yeah.
So you have that kind of heavy, really heavy weight to it. And I think this would be awesome with like that faux bronze finish like you do on the Cthulhu.
Oh, yeah.
Do kind of a faux metal.
Yeah.
Would be pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Especially if it was really heavy.
Yeah.
Because yeah. It looks like it should be heavy.
Oh, yeah.
And I think some people, too, when they hold something, the weight adds value in their mind
mm-hmm.
to a piece as well.
Yeah. No, I totally get it. You know, I always have always tried to keep prices down for mm-hmm. people, you know, so that they can afford stuff. And, you know, those of you that know me or have followed me, you know, for a while now know that, you know, I don't mass produce in China. I do everything hands on, and it's me from beginning to end. And I mean, of course, I've got
now people can see it.
Yeah. Now everybody can actually watch it come to life. So yep. That's good. That's a good thing. And maybe that'll help people out a little bit. So let's see here. Ah, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I work incredibly hard to try to bring out as much detail as I can. And so I appreciate that. Call me Musty. I put a lot of pride in my work, and I'm incredibly hard on myself. You know,
yeah.
If something isn't jiving, I get,
that's putting it mildly.
Well, yeah. So I just, you know, my passion comes through on my stuff, I'm hoping. And I want people that take the time to check out my stuff and, or even get stuff at shows when we go to Comic Cons and stuff. You know, I want them to feel like they're getting, you know, an awesome piece of work, you know, and, I'm thankful for everybody that's come by and talked to me and just made comments. And so it's very, very kind of you. Thank you very much. So.
Buzzing cell phone.
Yeah. I got it buzzed. It's just letting me know that it's there. So.
Like, I gotta watch for that stink bug.
Yeah.
It sounds just like the vibration of that phone.
Yep. David has a stink bug that shows up every single time he's in here. That stink
today,
bug
though.
Shows up, and
yeah, they've been out this year.
Yep, they sure have.
Actually, I had a spider drop down. I was going through the drive-thru the other day,
mm-hmm.
and it must have been on my hat when I put it on in the house. And so I'm sitting there. I was wondering, the lady at the drive-thru was kind of looking at me odd, and I was like, "What is she looking at?" And like, there was nothing. And so then I go through and I get, you know, park, and I open up my burger, and right as I go to take a bite, down comes a spider right off the brim of my hat, almost right into the burger. So good thing that my eyes were open.
Yeah. So David is terrified of.
I just don't like him.
We call that terrified.
I don't want him on me.
No.
I used to be. Now I can at least stand him, because here he goes dropping down into my burger nearly, and I just gave him a good flick right to the dashboard and finished him off over there. Whereas before, I've actually pulled over. When there was one on my drive, my dashboard, I pulled over and got out of the car once.
Oh, because
so I
didn't
crash.
You're freaking out.
It was one of those really big jumpers that look like a mini tarantula, and I'm like, I'm not gonna let that affect my driving.
Freak you out.
So I pulled over very quickly and took care of him.
That's good.
Took very good care of him.
Travis, I'm not seeing your text. I think I saw a picture of Riley, but it's not, for some reason it's not actually showing the picture. So anyway, I appreciate you, Riley. If you're whoever's watching this over there with my brother in Arizona, I say hi to all the family out there. Thank you for tuning in. Appreciate it. But yeah, we're just gonna be, not sure how long this stream's gonna go today, of course, but. We're just gonna keep cranking along, and like I said, this thing is pretty darn close to being done. Just some smoothing, some little textures and little details I'd like to kind of get cleaned up a little bit, and we'll see how this goes today. Maybe I can. I really like to have Katie in here too when we're doing the streams, and she's the one that I'd like to. Have running it while you and I are working on doing the molding of it, because it can get kind of overwhelming when you're trying to mold something up. So we'll see. And she's usually open most weekends anyway, that can come in and help us out. So So I'm going to just try to jump in here and focus on some of these teeth. As some of you may or may not know, I'm actually a dental technician by day, so teeth to me are incredibly important on my sculpts, and you'll see that in most of my works that I've done in the past. Most of the teeth, it's amazing. Most people, 90%+ of the people, don't even know that it's that the teeth are actually all anatomically correct and in their proper positions. Yep. There's nothing more, I think, disturbing to me than when I look, you know, and I see, you know, like a bust or a statue or a skull from the Halloween store or whatever, and they have like these teeth that are just like
squares
yeah. like chiclets that are just they're all identical. They're all identical. I just, as a dental technician especially, that just drives me straight up a wall. So
people who aren't, you know, they don't know teeth that well, can definitely see the difference though. You see your stuff, that's like a huge comment that people make, is like, wow, these teeth are amazing. And I think people just subconsciously don't pick up on it until they see the difference. Halloween store stuff, like that skull I worked with, you know, a week ago, was the stupidest looking teeth. But there was nothing I could do to really fix it. Otherwise, rip them all out and put acrylics in or something. Teeth are a big deal. Especially on yours, even at that small scale. Even on this, it's a large sculpt, but the mouth is very small in relation, and it still has full detail.
In fact, I don't know if it's going to pick up here or not, but there's this tooth right there, and you can actually see, I've got the wash on it right now of the lighter fluid, but this tooth actually right there actually is a molar and it actually has anatomy built into it. You can't really see it with this camera picking it up, but there's a slight little bit of anatomy built in, and it's just important to me. Mm-hmm. Most people aren't even going to see that or know that, but they do now, or at least they know now. But and the teeth anatomy and stuff to me is pretty darn important. So with this bust, I wanted to really drive the point home of, you know, that the character inside the rhino suit is the skin is actually the nice rough rhino look. So you can see, you know, how thick that rhino skin is. There's certain sculpts and stuff, I'm looking at one right now across the room, that it just has the face, and then the skin has this tiny little lip that comes up.
Carve a little line.
I wanted it to be this heavy, thick, you know, like he's suffocating in this suit, because in reality, that's, you know, you follow the rhino comic, or, you know anything about the rhino character. He really is. The skin has locked onto him, and, you know, and he can't seem to, you know, he's bonded with the skin now. So to me, that was very important to get that sense of claustrophobic, you know, because a lot of the other rhinos and stuff I see too, that like more of the face is shown, like you see like the bottom portion of his chin. I took it all the way up to the lip, because I've just suffocation.
This reminds me of you wearing that first sludge hood.
Because
that's about how much of your face shows before the hockey mask goes on. And it was a pretty thick one too.
We did a custom silicone hood. And it was right, basically, we were getting into it for the first time. We were starting to figure out how silicone really worked. And we just took a life cast of, you know, just a generic life cast. And we were able to do a mold, you know, brush on the silicone around it. And, of course, you know, we made it so thick that it was, you know, I mean, and it was heavy. Like, you put that sucker on, and, I mean, I was just, you know, ugh.
Yeah, on average, it's about twice as thick as the standard silicone mask that you might buy at, you know, any online retailer. But it was also using Equiflex 0030, which is very soft, so it does need to be a little thicker to have that strength. But now we're looking at like the new dragon skins and some of that, which has a lot more durability at a thinner depth. But yeah, that face reminds me a lot of that first time you put it on. It was really like right over the bottom lip.
That was a unique hood, and I wore that hood for
3 years?
No, Like, oh yeah, it was probably closer to five, I think,
Yeah,
because
could
I
be.
had that hood for quite a while.
Yeah,
And
because yeah, it must have been because that was like
last,
2011, I think. We did it for Halloween that year, 2011. Yeah, so that's
yeah,
five
5 years,
years. Yeah.
yeah, because I debuted a new
Yep.
hood this year and I
Yep.
worked on it and
Yep.
got a new one. Which by the way, I'm going to show that in a future stream. I just
Yeah.
I think it's important that, the people get to see, the monster sludge during Halloween time.
Oh yeah.
So
Then actually, that would be a fun stream too. Is just building another custom hood,
oh yeah.
because really that's an afternoon project.
Yep.
Even with adding color and paint and everything, we could do it in an afternoon through an evening,
Yep.
and do a full hood.
Yeah, that'd
Be
be
kind of fun.
awesome. Yeah. People get to see us sculpt in a
Yep.
different with a different medium,
Yep.
which is pretty fun. So what I like to do with this is I like to take my pointed carver here, which is actually incredibly sharp. So for you fellow sculptors out there, that have ever experienced the joy of jabbing one of these bad mamma jammas into your leg, the worst is when you drop it, because your
Oh
automatic
yeah.
thing is to stop. You close your clamp your legs, and no,
No.
that's not a fun thing to jab into your leg. But anyway, so
Or
I.
directly into your fingertip like last week or
Oh
whatever it
yeah,
was.
last week I was working. We were just in the living room. I was sculpting, and David was playing a game, and I'm working away on this just a sculpt, and I had the sculpt in my hand like this, and then there was a chunk of clay down here. And what I do is when I get, when I get clay on the end of this, the clay sticks to the end of the carver. So then I just jab it like that. Well, I've done this a thousand times over, and this was one of those times where I just slipped, and instead of hitting here, I hit directly right there, and man, I punched a
Yeah,
hole
it bled a
oh
lot
bad.
more than I
So
thought it would.
yeah, so that was pretty sucky, but
Test your blood sugar. Test it
oh
often.
yeah, well
Diabetes.
I yeah, had diabetes. Yeah. So what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna take my sharp carver here and my needle point, and I like to dig in deep, and then I'll kind of just roll those edges a little bit so it kind of softens it up. And I've spent a lot of time studying the skin of a rhino, just because I wanted to incorporate as much realism, even though it's a Marvel character, like a fabricated character. I wanted to make the skin as real as possible, that what a real rhino would have. And so I wanted that to translate in to the sculpt itself. And I think I've done a pretty good job of capturing that. There's a lot of, if a lot of these, large bumps, a lot of damaged horns. And I kind of have a tendency to go over the top when it comes to doing detail and anatomy and all those types of textures and stuff. But I think for the rhino, it worked actually quite nicely. So we'll see how that goes, how it turns out, because once it gets molded up, that's it. But there's a top view here. And there's the back shot. Nice wide. I wanted a really wide look to this character because he is such a big beast. I just definitely wanted mass to him. And I also like the way that the skin, and this is, you'll find this with everyday rhinos as well. One of the things I noted was that their skin actually overlapped. So there's these big folds, these big skin folds and stuff, and I always thought that was just great, just that real aggressive, thick, heavy, textured look to the rhino skin. So figured I'd incorporate that in there. You can also achieve kind of a uniformity of the texture itself by doing, instead of going with the groove, because you just saw how I deepened this one here, to get that softened up, you know, you get your lighter fluid on the end of your brush, and then you just kind of gently flow it in, and you can actually push it into those deep grooves, and that will soften it up. The lighter fluid has a tendency to be pretty aggressive with the clay, eats it up oh so gently, but it's pretty aggressive. Like if you keep going it over it over and over, it will start eventually wearing it down. So that's the nice thing about the lighter fluid itself is you can go with it and then you can go against it. And when you go against it, that's when it starts to really give an overall blending of all the lines together as a whole, rather than just one single ditch
You can
of a
see how it
deep.
gets kind of cloudy too. So that's the actual melted clay surface that mixes in with the lighter fluid.
Yeah, I don't know if you can pick up on that lighter, or you can see on that brush, all that is the residue
The
of
clay
the,
sludge.
yeah, the clay of the clay sludge there. So thank you very much, Travis. The stream looks great. That's good to hear. Glad to hear that. I'm hoping that we were noticing, we were talking about that live playback,
Local
or the
recording.
local recording, excuse me, and it had kind of that strange color to it. I don't really quite know what color to call that, or if it was even a color
No,
compression.
it's a compression issue with the dynamic range of the color
Yeah,
settings.
so that's
So.
David's my tech guy. Travis is my tech guy too, from a distant land, but yeah, I don't know nothing about that stuff. I just know it has that weird look to it. But apparently, for the streaming portion of things, it's not really gonna
No, because it's two different
affect.
processes.
Yeah, so.
So, looks pretty good.
Yeah.
And you got nice consistent frame rates on all the cameras. Looks
Yeah.
really nice.
Yeah, it's good. One of these days, I am gonna go to a bigger, different camera angle. I do have this one right now where it's the kind of that over the shoulder look here, and we did have it set up on the studio itself, on up on the showed more of the studio. This is more of a tighter view, but it's all good. So, but yeah, that way it gives people a chance to kind of see a different angle. And like I said, I do plan on adding another camera. Over by the paint station and grinding. Maybe I'll mount it up on that top gorilla rack up there so people can kind of see what's going on when I'm doing painting and all that stuff. What I need to do is I need to get a different I need to get a different compressor, because that
Oh yeah,
that
it's so
five
loud.
I've got that 5 gallon compressor, and man, it's great when it's full, but man, as soon as I start using an airbrush on that thing and it starts to tear down at the bottom of that reservoir of air, man, that sucker just kicks, and it actually startles me, because because I'm so focused on what it is I'm doing when that thing goes off, man.
Yeah, and the sound in the garage here just like
Ugh.
way too strong.
Yeah, just boom, and I mean, it'll actually startle you, so if you're not paying attention, so.
I do still have that little airbrush, like makeup airbrush compressor. So
Oh.
if I can ever remember to bring it, I'll bring it over and you can test it
Yeah.
out. Because it provides enough airflow for basic painting and makeup purposes.
Oh.
And it's not very loud.
Oh,
So,
okay. Yeah.
yeah.
Well, trust me, I'll send you a text to
Cool.
remember.
Yep.
But yeah.
Yeah, because I know exactly where it is. Whether I
Good.
know where the AC adapter is, that's another question.
Oh God. Yeah. Yeah, this isn't looking too shabby. I mean, like I said, folks, we are so stinking close to getting this thing finished. But like I said, I think once I do kind of a light blending of to tie everything in, then I'm gonna go underneath here and do my seam line or my finish line. You can actually see. So the bottom of this is how thick it's going to be overall when I do my slush cast. And then this tells me that this is my stopping point. When I'm actually looking inside the mold, I can see the bottom of the sculpt and in the mold, and then that's the finish line. So technically I don't even really have to clean this up per se, because I can come back in with a Dremel tool. But I do like a little bit of texture on the bottoms of these. And in fact, if I've got a Not sure if I've got a rock in here somewhere. Usually I use a rock or something to texture, and of course I'm not going to have one on me today. Let's see here. I know it's in here somewhere. Oh yeah, here we go. Yeah, so what I'll do is I'll come up under here. Oh, I feel this thing's So what I'll do is I'll just come up underneath, and I've got my little textured rock, and then I'll just lightly press it in, and you can see it'll start to leave little random textures. So depending on which size of rock I'm using, or how hard I press in, or what I'm doing here, it's going to leave a nice, uniform, or not uniform, that's the word I'm not wanting to use. It just has a nice texture to it, and then I'll just come back in and lightly dab some lighter fluid over it to soften up those edges. But I like the damaged, you know, the damaged look there. I'm not sure how well that's going to pick up in the camera. Plus this thing is a little slimy from all the lighter fluid, but so the lighter fluid will eventually evaporate out, and then I'll be able to handle it a little more. So anyway, we're going to shoot back over here to this view for the people to see me here. So, and I think I'm going to work back up here in this little eye area, the little tiny wrinkle and fold there. I'm not happy with it. It's kind of washed looking. That's the crazy part about working with this lighter fluid is when you start to apply the lighter fluid, if you're not careful, the lighter fluid will puddle up. And then especially if you've got grooves and ruts, when you carve that in, that lighter fluid sits back here. I might be working on the back half, but it's slowly, you know, running down this front groove, and it might run all the way down to the bottom and up back around the other side if you're not careful. So the lighter fluid travels pretty quick.
And it continues to soften all the way through,
and it,
too.
And it does. Yep. Yeah, so you kind of have to always have your eyes peeled. Also, what you can do, and I've used this on so many sculpts, because it's just such a great texture, but this is just a natural sea sponge, I guess. Is that what we call it? Natural sea sponge. Anyway, so yeah, and I just cut a piece of that, and then you can actually come in and it'll leave a texture, which is not, I don't think is going to pick up on this camera because of the contrasts and all that, whatever.
You might
it
see
is.
It kind of matte down the glossy surface.
Though. Yeah, you'll see it matte down the glossy surface, which is, but take my word for it, it is leaving a little bit of a texture, which actually works to my favor and my benefit if I'm trying to disguise little imperfections, you know, in the clay or whatever it is that, you know, whatever it is I'm not happy with. You can just lighter fluid the tar out of this thing and then just slam that thing in there and blend it all together that way. Now, one of the things I've noticed here after just kind of looking this over, I'm really happy with this area here, but this area right here, and again, I don't think you can really see it that great just with this camera, but there's quite a few little imperfections that I'm not digging right here in this area. There's a strange little weird lip going on here, and then there's lots of little dig marks there. So I'm just going to, and then this little area right here also is... not to my liking, so I am going to gently clean that area up. Now this is again where we have to be careful, because like we were just saying, the lighter fluid is in there, and it's going to want to have a tendency to
this is a hard one to turn at angle.
It really is.
It's so heavy.
It is,
and there's not a great angle or grip.
Nope. And I'm hanging on to this little tiny base, which you know, that is what it is. Yep. But oh wells.
Do you have like wire or something connecting up into the clay to that wood, or is it just stuck to it?
You know, I don't know. This is a resin.
It doesn't have like the foil inside as usual, so I wasn't sure if there was any kind of nail.
It probably has a wire running up inside of there, but I don't know. We'll see.
Then you wouldn't want to risk holding just the base.
Well, you know, what's funny is usually, like I said, I hang on to the bottom of the sculpt itself, you know, as I'm working on it. So it gives it kind of a stability, but I don't know, man. It's, I think there's a wire. I'm pretty sure I would have been smart enough to put a wire in there knowing that this is a lot of, you know, resin going, or a lot of, you know, clay, and this stuff is pretty darn heavy, like I said, so I have to eventually take breaks, and that way I don't get hand cramps and pay the price tomorrow. So, by the way, I just wanted to actually take a few minutes here to plug David Batman 1980, his stream. David, you want to tell us a little bit about what you're doing there, buddy?
Yeah, so my stream is based on actual arcade and pinball machine gameplay from the 80s and 90s. So real arcade hardware, dedicated cabinets, real pinball machines. And it's sort of pro wrestling themed, but we cover a lot of different areas. But I have the Stern WrestleMania pinball machine from last year and the Data East Royal Rumble pinball.
So what game don't you have?
There's a few.
Well,
but I have a lot.
How many games total?
So there's 7 pinball machines and about 50 arcade games, although only about 35 of those actually work at the current time. And I'm rearranging them around the house and trying to get them out to a storage unit so I can actually work on the house and then kind of bring them back. But the front room is really the Twitch stream room, so it's all the pinball machines, Mortal Kombat 1 and 2, WrestleMania, the four-player WrestleFest, Road Blasters and Race Driving. So there's a whole bunch of games. And actually, I wanted to stream one of the racing games, which I may do tomorrow, but depending on the schedule for going to Texas, who knows?
Well, you've got a lot on your plate. I mean, you do what you want to do, but if I was you, I would rest and take it easy and get your stuff ready for WrestleMania.
There's a lot of stuff I got to do tomorrow.
Yep. So I wouldn't be streaming right off the bat, but that's just me.
Don't be surprised if I have a stream tonight.
Well,
there you go. Don't be surprised, but yeah. But yeah, we've got all sorts of fun stuff going on. I usually stream at least once a week, if not twice. But no set schedule.
Yeah.
So it's usually late night, though. And we're in Pacific time zone, so it's typically anywhere from 10 p.m. or later. So if you're on the East Coast, it'll be early morning.
Yeah. What's funny is I'll get up at, you know, I'm up at 4 a.m., you know, for the most part. And I'll check, you know, Twitch just to see, you know, what kind of crazy people are streaming right now. And then, of course, I look on there and there's David Batman 1980. So
Playing pinball. 6 hours.
Yeah. And then he'll be like, oh, man, I've just been on here for, you know, 8 hours. Yeah. I'm like, wow, really? You just left my house like, you know, 10 hours ago.
Yeah. It was really like I went home, I slept, and I woke up and started streaming. And then it was like literally 7 hours later.
Yep.
And it was Tuesday morning.
Yep. That's amazing. But anyway, yeah, so if you guys, if anybody is interested in pinballs or arcade games, and he's a good guy, and he also has a ton of awesome stuff in his house, which you can see some of it, you know, just on the camera angles and stuff. But man, I've had the distinct privilege to walk through his house and be a part of it, and it is awesome. So
stammer through.
climb over stuff.
Overcrowded at the moment.
Yep. But it's overcrowded with awesome stuff.
Yeah, good stuff.
Yeah.
So it's like Hoarders, but with cool stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Boy, that is a cool. I should call the Hoarders show and surprise you and have them come in. And then you could be like, just promote your stuff and then tell them to get out.
Yeah.
That's what I would do.
You get out.
Yeah, get out right now.
No. But yeah, the stream is kind of fun and I really enjoy doing it. Right now, because there's so much crowded stuff going on, I have like cables for all the cameras draped over machines just to get into the right spot for whatever game I'm playing to angle those cameras properly. But it's actually a lot of fun doing the pinball, playing pinball. A lot of people don't even realize pinball is like making a huge comeback or that it even still exists. So a lot of the viewers that come in, especially in those odd hours, have no idea that pinball, like real pinball, is even something people play, let alone stream live on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
So pretty exciting.
Yeah, it's cool. It's
and
really
of course,
cool.
At the moment, there's like 6 other dedicated pinball streaming channels running right now, which is really exciting.
You mean right now?
Right now, there's like 5 or 6 of the people I follow regularly have streams going on at live pinball.
Wow.
Which is always exciting.
Yeah. Must be driving you crazy to be sitting here in the studio and not...
I'm secretly watching.
I know you are. I know you are, you son of a gun. You son of a bee.
I feel bad because one of the guys that I watch all the time, he was doing his big 500 follower celebration stream on Monday, and I slept through the whole thing, so I feel really bad.
Yeah. He mentioned something about that. I remember that.
Well, he's streaming right now the brand new Hobbit pinball machine, which is actually just shipping in the last couple of weeks.
Wow.
So he's got several friends that live locally that have literally like 50 machines in one location and like 20 some in another. And he brings his computer and his cameras over, and they stream on different games there. So once a week, he goes to one of their houses and does this amazing stream, which is really exciting.
That's cool. I like the mutation part of this Rhino bust. I was actually just looking at some of this overlapping detail here, and I think I'm gonna switch it back to the other wide camera so people can see it a little better. But this section here, I really like this. It has this, you know, you can see the Rhino skin there. It's not just random willy-nilliness. It's you can actually follow the skin folds of how it goes, you know, for this particular sculpt, and even just around the back, you know, it comes up and droops down and hangs over. So I just like that just that you could tell that he's just rugged, you know, like he's just a thick skin and just, you
and
know,
there's a visual weight to it as well. So you look at it and you just feel that it's
oh yeah, and it kind of yeah, and it kind of goes back to that you know, that claustrophobic, you know, thing I was talking about, where I wanted to sculpt him where he just looks like he was suffocating in this thick, heavy Rhino skin, which would be awesome, by the way. If I you know, I always thought it'd be kind of fun to have a thick skin of Rhino, thin skin, thick skin. Until it actually happens, and I'll be like, man, this sucks. I want to be a bird with like little feathers that are light.
It reminds me of that scene from Ace Ventura 2.
Yeah, where he's
when he's inside the robotic Rhino and then starts sliding out because it's so hot.
Yep.
And the little kid sees him coming out of the Rhino.
Yeah. Look, mommy's giving birth. Yeah.
What do you know about them rhinos?
Yeah. It's awesome. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm just kind of trying to look over this whole thing to get kind of an idea of what needs texture and what doesn't. There's certain areas that, you know, are kind of I guess lacking or kind of incomplete, I guess. And there's couple little spots here that I'm seeing that I can improve upon, but we'll see how this goes. I'm just gonna kind of dig this in and blend it a little bit more.
Yeah, with this kind of skin, you have like those really big folds and wrinkles, and there's the smaller ones, and then you have some that are like hairline that are so thin.
Yeah.
That are there, but they don't really pop out. And then for the other areas, then you can use like the sponge or the rock to kind of texturize the skin in between, where it doesn't necessarily need a visual fold or a crease.
And please understand that my goal is to break this thing up and make it look, like I said, as natural as possible, but also as detailed as possible. So there's that, you know, there's that randomness of the skin itself, but at the same time, it's, you know, broke up and
follows kind of the natural folds of like anatomically skin folds in certain ways in certain areas based on the motion. If it's done correctly, you can actually see how you would normally be turning and moving based on the way the skin is folded or wrinkled.
Yeah,
which is really cool.
Yep. Yeah, and I liked, you know, unfortunately because it is just the straight bust shot, you know, there's not much movement, but if I wanted to really drive that point home, you know, that he's, you know, there is a slight shift. And you can see it in the pattern of the flow of the resin, or the, I knew I was going to say resin, of the clay.
Yeah. The pattern of the folds and the wrinkles and stuff imply like what he would look like when he's turning.
Yep.
Because that turn constantly creates those creases.
Mm-hmm.
Just like the little, you know, crow's feet on people's face from scowling.
Oh, yeah.
That same type of constant creasing, you know, creates those little crossover folds and wrinkles.
Yep.
Which is pretty cool.
Yeah. It's awesome.
That's one thing on a lot of sculpts. Sometimes you see people will kind of fake the folds and wrinkles.
Yep.
But if they don't know why they would normally fold that way, or they don't have that anatomy knowledge of the underlying muscles,
mm-hmm.
you can tell it doesn't look right.
Yeah.
And sometimes you won't necessarily know why it doesn't look right, but if the folds are going the wrong direction that they normally would, then it sometimes throws it off. And
yeah.
that's one thing like this. There's a lot of motion just looking at the way that the skin is drooping.
Oh, yeah.
It implies a lot of motion.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I agree. Totally agree.
And it's way better than the rhino at the end of Spider-Man 3.
Well, thank you.
Since that was a massive exoskeleton robot with Paul Giamatti inside.
Well, here's the deal. I, you know, I like to keep things PG, of course. You know, so I'm not gonna say what I really think of it. Yeah, but
I don't know why they went that direction.
The spits. I don't know, man. It's terrible.
Thankfully, they never followed through because they ended that series after that flop of a third movie.
Oh.
So that's when they reset and went back to Amazing Spider-Man.
Oh,
so
well, that's good.
It was the third Tobey Maguire movie that was awful.
Yeah.
There were very few moments in there that were fun, but the whole movie as a whole was just awful.
Yeah.
And they tried to shoehorn too many things in at once.
Yep.
And went too CG heavy and got rid of, you know, decent storylines.
Yeah. And then, like we were talking here not too long ago,
mm-hmm.
they try to shove so much stuff into a movie. And it's like, look, guys, we get it. You know, we know that you've got this budget, you know,
yeah.
okay, whoop-dee-dee-doo, but don't blow it all in one movie that
right.
has everything so rushed. Just
yeah.
slow down, pace
yep.
this thing out, you
yep.
know, make yourself money over, you know, the course of the years, you know, rather than one
yeah.
summer. Just give
right.
build it up a little bit.
Yeah,
because
you really, it kind of minimizes the effectiveness of everything when you put too much stuff in.
Because mm-hmm.
really, like, movies are pushing that 2.5 hour mark on a consistent basis these days, and already they're having to trim stuff to get it to 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
And it's like, pace it out, make one good movie or two good movies instead of one that's
yeah.
jammed together and having to trim so much out of it.
Yep.
Which that's actually one of the major complaints of many of the new Batman and Superman movie
yeah.
is that they actually, there's a lot of deleted scenes that actually make sense that should be in the movie
mm-hmm.
that because they were removed for timing purposes actually take away from the flow of the story.
Yeah.
And so I'm kind of surprised. I assume when they release it on Blu-ray, it'll have the deleted scenes built in.
Yeah.
So they'll do a director's cut, which is going to be like 3 hours.
Mm-hmm.
But it makes sense because when you think of like Watchmen, you
yeah.
know, Watchmen in the movies was really long,
yeah.
and then the director's cut was nearly 4 hours
Ugh.
Because they shot so much, which in some ways is good if you're following like the source material.
Yeah.
Other times, maybe there's just too much.
Yep.
And it's like, you don't really need to have that fourth or fifth character that should have its own movie.
Yeah. No, I was, for me, when I, you know, watched the Freddy versus Jason, which
mm-hmm.
was, you know, I really enjoyed, you
yeah.
know, which it was what it was, you know. But I thought, man, only an hour and a half for, you know, two classic
yeah.
icons
yeah.
fighting. Are you kidding? Like, man, make this.
Yeah.
I mean, Lord of the Rings, for crying out loud, is 5 hours long.
Yeah.
And you're just like, oh, like, I can't take any more of these hobbits. But anyway, yeah. Yeah, so anyway. So what I did also on this was I talked a little bit ago about the undercut of this, the finish line, and there you can see where I've scribed it in. So this is where the sculpt is going to end, and then this is the underneath side where this is all going to be eliminated, and
yeah,
it's going to be a slush cast.
Yep.
Yeah, so I'm right now I'm just kind of going up underneath there to really define that finish line, and there you can see right there, that's where I want my finish line to go. So it might be that thick
mm-hmm.
all the way around, you know.
Yeah.
It doesn't
appear to be that.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
It'll yeah. So I'm gonna be making sure that all my slush cast, this is something I've kind of switched to, is going to a slush cast to save cost and materials for people and myself, of course.
But
it's
a unique display too.
And it does. It gives it kind of that museum.
Kind of, yeah.
It looks
amazing.
The museum. In fact, I don't know if I've got any I don't think I have any available to show.
Nope.
I guess actually that's not true. I do have one
yeah.
here. But I don't have the base for this one just mm-hmm. yet. But yeah, so this is my Whale Man bust. And you can see, you know, it goes all the way around, of course, but then this is the inside, and that's the slush cast. So there's
it's really nice and thick.
Oh yeah, it's yeah. That's one thing I just don't, you know, I don't want to compromise is doing a thin casting, because I've seen some stuff where the people have cast this and it's so thin that you can actually push on it and it you can punch a hole right through it. Yep. So I don't believe in that. I believe in nice thick solid castings that, you know, are definitely giving yourself protection for your sculpt, especially around these edges. If you'll notice, you know, these edges, this is, you know, what, maybe 3/4 of an inch, maybe?
At least.
You know,
not,
thick?
Not 3/4.
Not 3/4?
No, that's like maybe 3/8.
3/8.
If
3/4, 3/8, yeah. But there's certain parts of it that are really thick.
Based on the size of the sculpt, you've got a good thickness in there that's not going to crack or have any weak areas.
Yeah.
So it just depends. So like this Rhino, you would probably go even thicker than that.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Because of the size.
Yeah. So here's another one. This one's a much larger scale. This is Gretchen. Oh, hey, Clean Slate Customs is joining us today on the live stream. Thank you so much. I appreciate you joining and tuning in. Yes, I was just telling them about these slush casts that I do. So here's the inside of this one, and you know, it's nice and thick and durable, and this one's going to be haired up, and this one, but I actually offer this also in a full baby form, yep, where there's the swaddle and all that good stuff for all you haunters out there. But yeah, so that's how I do it. Compared to my solid casts, which this is my Freddy one that actually is a solid. And this was actually before I started doing the slush. So this was, I didn't do the slush on this one because it's just a back and it, there wouldn't be enough support. If I would have brought it down to here, then, you know, then so be it. But I left it open. So this is a solid cast, and I'm actually really happy with this piece. Yeah. So,
and some sculpts really work well as a solid cast. It's just a lot of material.
Yeah.
But I think like this Rhino would be cool as maybe a limited edition, cast some solid ones just like that.
Yeah.
Which I think would be really neat.
Yeah.
I like the weight of that too, because you have a solid resin, it's going to feel heavy.
Oh, yeah. Well, God, I mean, the clay alone. Seriously,
know,
like my wrist is hurting. My camera setup for this piece is probably not the best. I should have probably got it on the, you know, on the turntable, ditched the overhead cam and used the side cam here.
Yeah, just readjust that one to a different angle.
Yeah, so that's probably what I should have done, was had it sitting up on my little lazy Susan and adjusting it, sculpting that way. But yeah, this sucker, I'd love to find out how much this thing weighs. It's got, I swear,
you
it's
got your scale for,
yeah, it's around here somewhere
stuff, but yeah, it's pretty heavy.
Yeah. it's a heavy piece, so maybe next time I'll do it better. I'll think about that a little better next time. Dang it. But yeah, so anyway, so Clean Slate, by the way, Clean Slate Customs is a gentleman that I follow on Instagram.
Oh,
and
cool.
if you guys have an Instagram, you should head over there and check him out, as we would say, and our Canadian friends would say, check him out. He's got really cool stuff, and he does modifications to action figures and all those awesome things. I always enjoy seeing his pics. So if you get a chance to go check him out over there, check him out on Instagram. And also, I would highly suggest Clean Slate that you get yourself a Twitch and do what you do, but bring it to the masses people can see what you're doing to the characters.
It's so nice seeing the creative channel growing with so many people doing more than just digital painting.
Oh,
yeah. It's kind of fun in a way, but it's nice to see actual, you know, sculpture and model building and all sorts of different craft hobbies being displayed.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's really really cool to see that too, you know, like you were just saying. There's quite a few people that I found that I really enjoy watching, and they're just some amazingly talented people out there, and so it's pretty cool, pretty awesome. So
yeah, it's so funny to be on a video game streaming channel to see how it's grown into creative.
Yeah,
you know, and then with music and pinball and all this other stuff that's not really like video gaming that it started out with.
Yeah, and that should say something. I mean, not that there's anything wrong with video gaming.
No,
you know,
it's neat to see that expansion.
Yeah, to see the actual growth of a different genre.
Because I would say the majority of people in the creative streams also do video game streams.
Yeah.
They've just kind of like shifted, so they do, you know, half on one or half on the other. But it's really neat. Even the cosplay streams are kind of interesting to watch people building costumes and weathering their own costumes.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, when we get close to Halloween, we can do a stream on working on our costumes. Which will be a lot of fun.
Well, and that's one of the main reasons, too. And my brother and I, we were talking about this actually just yesterday, I think it was. You know, there's a reason that I named it the Toby Wayne Show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, even though it's Toby Wayne Studios, mm-hmm. which is that's my business name and that's what I, you know, go to represent at the shows. The Toby Wayne Show is a representation mm-hmm. or an extension of Toby Wayne Studios.
Yeah.
But I called it the Toby Wayne Show because I want to keep it open.
Right.
You know, so that we can do streaming of the sculpts, you know, one night, and then mm-hmm. Friday nights we might sit around and talk about horror movies or whatever and just, you know, shoot the breeze with people, you know, and then, you know, then also, you know, I love to cook, so it'd be kind of fun to mm-hmm. to do a cooking segment, you know, and it's just a lot of fun. It's, you know, it's really cool to get that interaction, and I sure appreciate the people and their follows. And so, yeah, feel free, please, to check out, shameless plug, you know, my other stuff. I've got my Instagram, my YouTube, and my, what else do I got? Instagram, YouTube, my website.
If you want to actually own an authentic, real one-to-one creation from Toby Wayne, you will be able to purchase that.
I'm going to be updating that here shortly, too.
Yeah.
But, I got all kinds of new stuff coming, and I'm excited about that. And that's all under the Toby Wayne Studios name.
Yep.
So it's just Instagram, you know,
Toby
Wayne Studios.
And we'll set
YouTube.
Up a bot, too, so that way we can put all the links out there, just putting a bot command in or have it automatically pop up, just so it automatically reminds people where else they can see you.
Yep. And
Instagram is a great place because then you're always posting new stuff there mm-hmm. and notifying when you're about to go live on Twitch.
So
that's a great way. If the Twitch notifications aren't working, the Instagram will.
And I apologize, folks, if for some reason you're not knowing if I go live because my brother, you know.
Well, and like mine too, the same thing.
Yeah.
And it's really, it's all individual customization.
Mm.
But I think that they have like a toggle switch that turns them all off by default. And then you have to go in and manually do each one.
Sounds like a flim flam.
I'll figure it out so we can make sure that we have the rules set up.
Yeah.
And we can easily do the IT tech support for people who need help setting up their alerts.
That would be me.
But we'll get it figured out. But yeah, once we get the bot set up too, it'll automatically post that stuff out there for
you. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
You know, and I had a Twitter at one point, and I just found it so absolutely pointless that, mm-hmm. You know, but I guess that's what a lot of people do with their streams is they'll go on Twitch and shout it out
it's just another way to send out notifications.
Yeah.
And Twitter for me is it's just like Instagram, but text only. And so it's just like sending a text message to a friend, but you're sending it to anybody else who wants to listen in.
Yeah.
So it's for me, I use it for promotional stuff more than anything. I really don't have conversations on it or do much other than follow other people's basically news that I'm following
mm-hmm.
for other interesting purposes. Not really celebrity stuff. That's what a lot of people use it for. But I just like to get updates on products or software from places I'm interested in.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oddly enough, a lot of companies are actually doing tech support through Twitch or through Twitter.
Oh, really?
Which seems really odd to me. But they have people assigned to respond to tech requests, like Comcast has recently set one up.
Oh.
So you can actually tweet to Comcast for help. And it's like, well, that's amazing because you can't get help from them anyway when you call.
Yeah.
Although they've gotten better. So that's an improvement.
Yeah.
That they're reaching out in other methods.
But yeah.
I really don't use my Twitter for much of anything.
Yeah.
But it is a nice thing just for people who do use it often to be able to set up that reminder if you want to send out a note, and you can automate it too.
Yeah.
So it'll tweet for you. Then you don't have to worry about it.
I totally agree, good sir. I totally agree. Yes, I do.
Most of them are linked in so tightly that if you update one, it'll automatically filter out to all of the rest. And so you have to remember which one is your source social media to send it out. Because I've accidentally sent it out through two different methods, and all of a sudden it's duplicated on all channels.
Oh.
It's like, whoops. Because I don't want to spam people with stuff.
That's okay. So I've got a couple different tools here. And of course, being a dental tech, you know, is nice because I can always look and see which, you know, tools are the best for me personally because I work with them every single day. But here's one of my favorite tools. This is what we call a cleoid discoid in the dental business, which I don't expect you to remember that. But it has this kind of this cool little And of course, you're never going to be able to see it this small. But anyway, take my word for it. It's got a little tiny circular head on the end of it there, like a, almost like a needle head. And then this one has a kind of a sharp edge to it. And you can just get in really tight and real close. And so it's nice to get in there, because then, unlike this, you know, my sharp knife or my sharp pointer, this one actually has the shallow head on there, so I can actually manipulate the clay just a little better on the inside there, which is nice because I can get in. And then the dentists actually use this to clean teeth. They'll actually use these to go in and scrape.
Oh, for scraping.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this comes in quite handy, as you can imagine. Getting on the inside there and smoothing that stuff out. And molding this one up is going to be interesting because there is, you know, and so that's one thing too I want to talk about, you know, when we're, since we're here, you know, working with undercuts. Before, back in the day, I probably would have just done this as a block mold, which would have been a ton of silicone, because it would have been, you know, looking down on this, you know, you would have had your box that is this, you know, but actually the tip of the horn actually pushes it out. So you have to be a half inch on each side.
And above.
And yeah, and a half inch above.
Think about all that.
Yeah, right, so there. All of this chunk here is completely wasted silicone, because it's, you know, all the way back, all the way to here.
Solid
chunks of silicone. I don't think I have a... I don't think I have a block mold available. Oh, yes, I do.
Yep, this one up there.
Hold still with me here for a second. Yeah, so this, my friends, this is what we call a block mold. And this is what I had That's done.
An expensive one, too.
Yeah, this is a really expensive one. In fact, I'm not even sure which one this one is. Who is this? Oh, it's Mr. Bubbles. Mm. Yeah, Mr. Bubbles. But this is a block mold, and I mean, this sucker weighs a ton. Holy cows. But this is what I used to use back in the day, and I never even did beauty coats when I would do these.
Yeah, dump them in.
Yeah, you build your box, and you just pour it down the side, and it just sheens and fills itself up. And now I've gone and switched over to, for the magnets, I do... different molds. I'll do a like a one part mold here, so it's more of a block, so you actually have your sculpt here, and then then the resin just, or the silicone just pours in, and then that's what you use for that.
They're kind of like plate molds.
Hey, Hound Cave, how you doing? Mr. Bubbles. Yeah, I have a Mr. Bubbles here somewhere.
I think it's no, it's not.
Did I package it away?
I think so.
Yeah, so
one of my favorite ones.
Yeah, he's a fun piece, but so now I was just talking about the block molds, but now I've switched over to the glove molds, which, as you can imagine, is going to save a ton of money all the way around the board. So these are glove molds, and you, here you can see there's, this is the back, and then it just splits wide open. So you're doing multiple layers of, you know, silicone brushed onto the sculpt itself, which this is what our good old friend here, Rhino, is going to end up having, because he is such a big piece, and there is all these little intricate undercuts and whatnot. And then, of course, back to the glove mold, it's supported with the motherboard, or the mother shell, the support shell.
Yep.
So it just all clips together, and then you just pour your silicone or your resin
and
in there.
And the little nubs just poke in and hold in place.
Yep, and then this just pours right in, and then you slush it around, and then the cast comes out.
And the purpose for the mother mold is to keep the silicone from flexing. So the silicone is still very soft, when it, especially when it's thin like that. So when you're pouring the resin in, if you don't have any kind of a hard shell to hold it in place, it will warp your cast. So some people will do it as brush on thick, and they'll try to pour it without a mother mold.
Oh, yeah.
But you always end up with a warped cast.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Hound Cave Productions. I really appreciate you coming in. I also love the horror theme. Isn't that the best? Everybody loves a good horror film. Well, not everybody, just those that aren't sick, twisted individuals. Mm-hmm. But yeah, so.
That's what you're all about here at the Toby.
That Show. That is. We're all about horror and
sculptures
and all that good stuff. So, and then, of course, as you can see up there in my past works, those are some, just some of the stuff that I've got done in the past and also in production and we're working on right now. But to kind of break from the horror theme, I'm actually doing a Rhino bust, and I love I do other characters, Marvel stuff, DC stuff, but I try to
mostly just because you're personally invested in those characters. Oh yeah, it's kind of a fun thing for you,
absolutely,
to do outside of the horror stuff. But even in that same vein, it's a pretty horrific character.
It is. He's yeah, he is. I mean, he's mutated, and he's
because your spin on it takes it to that dark side.
Yeah, not the best.
I think Captain America is maybe the only one that's like hero.
Yeah,
of like all of your sculpts, that's the most hero style one.
Yeah,
even though that zombie version was amazing.
one of the bust, or the little guys I want to get done here is this little guy. He is done. I have to build the block wall and do the
two-part mold.
Yeah, the two-part mold. But this guy is actually going to be I'm not sure how I'm going to package him. Mm-hmm. He might be in a little jar, kind of like my little
is its head wide enough to fit in one of these jars?
That I don't. That I don't know.
Could wedge him in there, because that jar would be awesome.
His head is way too big.
Squish in.
Yeah.
To be tightly packed.
Yeah, if we cast him in like a silicone or something, for sure.
Just squeeze him right in.
Yeah, for sure.
But come on, Bucko.
Pound Cave Productions. Thank you very much. I appreciate that very much. I hope you have a good time here on the Toby Wayne Show, because I know we're having a good time. I said have a good time.
Yes.
Okay. That's David Batman 1980. He's here in the studio physically with me today. And he's,
physically, maybe not mentally.
Yeah, mentally he's long gone. But
In the clouds.
The Marvel Zombies version. You know, it's funny that you should mention that. Hound Cave, let me go grab a bust I did, and I will be right back. David, do a song and dance.
Can't see it happening, but it's happening, I swear.
Oh, yeah, he's shucking and jiving, for sure.
There we go.
Yep, there's the foot shuffle.
Sorry, that gave Michael Flatley a run for his money.
Lord
of the Dance reference.
If I followed it, I'm sure I would have gotten it. But anyway, yeah, so here's a bust I did years ago. This was also an original Super Sculpey. When I say original, I mean... just having the
never had a mold. It was
there was no mold of it. But anyway, here's the Marvel Zombie Rhino I did about 10 years ago. Sorry, it's so dusty. he sits up on the top shelf, but
you can see some similarities too in this larger one.
Oh yeah,
in the overall kind of the facial structure and stuff,
except for the sizes.
the size is huge, but even like kind of the style of horns and. The shape and everything is very similar, which is awesome, because that's kind of a good idea of what this will look like, only bigger and more detailed.
Yeah, this was kind of the inspiration for the bigger pieces. And I knew I was eventually going to mold up a Rhino, but I wasn't sure which one it was going to be. Mm-hmm. So, we had fun with that one. Horror Hound Cave says, does the Batman user sculpt as well? And I'm assuming you're speaking of David Batman.
Oh yeah, that's
David
me.
Batman 1980.
So my Batman name is because I love Batman. I mean, we both do, but I love Batman so much.
Maybe
have...
as you can see by the awesome bat suit in the bat corner there that my beautiful bride was able to acquire from David.
Yep, that was one of about 8 bat suits I had.
Yeah,
I've gotten rid of a couple others, but so I do some sculpting. I'm primarily more of a technical sculptor, so I mold and cast and. But I have done my own sculpts, prosthetics, and a variety of different things. But I don't do it as frequently. My channel is based on arcade and pinball machines from the 80s and 90s.
Yeah.
So if you're into that too, I've got lots of fun pinball machines, including the Batman pinball machine.
Yeah, please head over and follow David Batman 1980, because he is a cheap plug.
Right here on twitch.tv.
Yeah. But so anyway... yeah, he actually helps me out in the studio. if I have a when we and I we are going to be doing a molding of one of these guys, so we're going to be
within the next month at the latest. But you want to have this done before the next show.
It'll probably be done. Yeah. So I may have my
this in the next week or two.
Yeah.
I'll be back next weekend.
Yep.
So we can probably schedule something then.
Yeah.
But yeah, if we do a molding process, if we start it like early on a Saturday, we could mold the entire thing by the end of the day, and then maybe do a follow up on Sunday with the mother mold.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm not sure that anybody would want to watch my mug for 12 hours a day.
Well, not everybody sits around the whole time. They come back and check in.
And I'm mesmerizing. Look at me.
That's why I can hear people vomiting so right now.
I know. I'm shrinking that down because I'm hideous. I'm like a Halloween mask with legs. I'm telling you. I'm hideous. I'm telling you.
No, it'll be cool. But I think the mold process, for me, is always interesting. I think a lot of people out there that are interested in this also find that interesting because it's something that even people who are sculpting haven't necessarily gotten into molding yet. It's nice to see other people do it.
Yeah.
I know that for me, when I was learning how to do it, it was great to watch YouTube videos of people molding something up to see their techniques and to watch it live and be able to ask questions as it's happening. Very yeah. cool.
Yep.
So we'll advertise it out there too. So
oh yeah. We're going
to sure to follow the Instagram and the other social media to be notified.
Yeah. I always, and for me, molding is my least favorite aspect of it. It just, I don't know. I would just rather, focus on the clay and the sculpting aspect of it. And then, but again, I've made the vow that, my hand is going to be in every single step from the concept that, the initial thought in my head all the way to the actual handing it over. If it's at all possible, it shows if you're ever in the area and different shows that I go to and you want to come down and see me in person. I always appreciate meeting everybody that's awesome, that comes out and gets all energized and excited. So it's very cool. Very cool. Very cool indeed.
That's cool. So Hound Cave Productions said another hobby enjoys is arcade and pinball restoration.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really cool.
Yeah.
So my stream also has not just gameplay, but also restoration and repair.
Yeah.
So I'm always working on
stuff. Sarah's lame, which, hopefully you're not, because you sound cool. And I hope I pronounce that right.
Her last name is Slam.
Sarah's, called her lame. Sarah's lame. Sarah's lame. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to slander you, but I agree. Yeah. Molding is, it's not bad, but it's just not my thing. I would rather much be doing the sculpting. And it's funny, Hound Cave says, is that a Nosferatu sculpt in the back, on the back shelf? And I gotta say, if my big fat head wasn't in the way, as a matter of fact, it is a Nosferatu sculpt, which, by the way, my wife has been pushing me and yelling at me and good. I'm glad you're not lame. So this is the, and I'm going to shoot to the wide camera here so people can see this a little better. But so this is the Nosferatu bust that I was working on. Also another very large and in charge piece. I've kind of upscaled my pieces. This one also would be a slush cast just due to the just sheer size of this thing. It's there, the sculpts and stuff, as David and I, we were talking about earlier, they just keep getting bigger, and we were kind of trying to give more bang for the buck. That's kind of the mindset that seems to be going on. People like to like bigger pieces. So it's just kind of important to get that bigger piece for people so they can feel like they're getting more for their money. But yeah, this piece is pretty big. I think this is 12 inches, 13 inches?
Yeah, it's pretty close. With the base on it, it's about 12.
Yeah. But this would be a hollow. And in fact, if you'll notice,
probably about half scale, I would say.
Half scale. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if you'll notice, I scribed a line in here. If I can pull this back up, you can see that's where I was actually thinking about just cutting all of that off and doing a hollow cast. Mm-hmm. So it would actually only be about this much, but you would be losing these edges, which
it depends.
Katie's no, don't.
I like the idea of it being large like that. Yeah. And you could even, if you didn't want to do a full resin casting, you can do the slush and then fill it with the expanding rigid foam. And then at the bottom, just fill it out.
Yeah.
So that way you still have a solid piece, but it's not extremely heavy.
Yeah.
But it's heavy enough, because yeah. if you did that solid, it would be almost as heavy as it is now.
Yeah.
It's full clay.
Let's see. let's see. Yes. Sarah says, what did you use for Nasta's eyes? Those are actually marbles. I learned that trick a long time ago.
That's where I lost them.
Yeah, I took David's marbles and he had no idea. And now they're in Nosferatu's head.
I've lost my marbles.
Yeah, he's lost his marbles. And that's okay. Because you got to be nuts to hang out with me. You got to be a little crazy. But yeah, so yep, that's the Nosferatu. I've got so many pieces that are this close to being done. I mean, I'm talking.
Do you have a little painted magnet one laying around? I know there's a raw cast, but I don't
actually, you know, if you want to go grab the ones off the fridge, magnet, a couple magnets.
That's a really
in there.
Cool sculpt too. It's different from the large bust.
Yeah, and I do. Oh, and there is another bust around here, or a magnet around here somewhere. We'll find it.
There's an unpainted one on the shelf there.
Yeah.
Let me find the painted version.
Yeah, we're kind of all over the board tonight, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. It was one of those last moment decisions to do a stream, and I had David here at the house, so I thought, why not? You know, let's do a live stream and see how this goes. So I appreciate each and every single one of you coming out here and taking the time to visit with us today. Very awesome. So thank you very much. I appreciate that. Yes, I agree, Sarah.
I was thinking there was that the gray painted one.
Yeah, I don't know where that blue one went to.
Yeah, kind of bluish with the red eyes.
But anyway, here's a Nosferatu magnet that I purchased. Now, before anybody says, well, that looks just like that looks just like Mr. Burns.
Yeah, this is Mr. Burns. There you go.
Yeah, so anyway, here's a couple of variants of the
Mr. Burns after his eye drops.
Yeah, after his eye drops. Here's a couple of the Nosferatu magnets that I've got. In fact, I have yet to take these to the show, so they're coming. In fact, I'm thinking they'll be in
Cherry
April.
City.
Yeah, I'll have them at Cherry City Comic Con in Salem. So
they just announced Margot Kidder is going to be there.
No way!
Isn't that amazing?
Lois Lane from the first Superman is going to be at Cherry City Comic Con. You know, I met her. Yeah, Travis the Overlord. There's the. Is that Mr. Burns? Smithers, who is that bumbling idiot?
Excellent.
Wow, that's Travis the Overlord, sir. Release the hounds. I actually met Margot at a Crypticon in 2010 in Seattle, Washington. And she didn't have any of the pictures that I really wanted to purchase from her, but I wanted to purchase something from her. So she actually had a copy of the issue of Playboy that she was in from 1970 a year or two before or after the Superman movie came out. There's a picture of Playboy from 1970s.
Uh-huh.
Okay. She was all natural. So
yeah.
I'm just going to leave it at that. I try to keep this sucker clean, but yeah. And that was her one requirement, was that she would do the shoot, but it had to be in black and white, and she had to be all natural. So
All natural.
Yeah. So I don't know what hair's like, so I lost that a long time ago. But anyway, that one went right in the toilet, but.
I was kind of wondering what would I bring to have her sign, if anything. And I thought, well, I've got the Superman DVD box, but I was going to have Tiny Lister sign the No Holds Barred Blu-ray.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Which would be kind of fun.
Yeah.
But, I can't think of...
It was beautiful. It was. It was very beautiful. Sweet gal. We actually ran into her in the elevator, and she had her therapy dog, or she had some kind of animal with her, and so it was interesting to be in an elevator with the original Lois Lane. It was pretty cool. Sweet lady, very very polite lady, very nice. Took the time to really talk to us and she was just a sweet lady. So anyway, I think I want to get a little more definition, maybe a little more. A thicker droop right there, I think. So I'm just going to add a little bit of clay in there. I'm just going to build that out just a little bit. That's a happy rhino skin. It's happy. So I'm just going to go ahead and build that out a little bit. smooth this in. One of the things too that I should mention is, and this, this is for me, primarily to just kind of get this off of my out of my mouth, out of my mind here. But a lot of the times it's really easy for me to miss, we focus so much straight on, and from the top and from the back and all those types of angles. But a lot of the times, and I'm sure other sculptors will mention this, or other hobbyists that maybe paint or whatnot, will say that the biggest thing that they forget is to do this up underneath, making sure that all the texture and everything lines up, because it's so easy to get lost when you're doing a sculpt and you're all over the board. I'm one of those guys that I'm so focused on this little tiny section right here that, and then I once I'm done here, when I'm applying the lighter fluid and it's too pliable, too soft to work with, I might jump all the way over onto this side down here at the bottom, so it's bouncing all over the board on this. And what Sarah was saying earlier about, starting on a piece and then not, and then fi trying to finish something before you start another one, which is next to impossible for me, because I get so gung-ho and excited about something, and that, and on top of the fact that it feels like it takes forever for me to finish a piece. So if I lose interest,
Yeah.
that this kind of
That's
stuff
why, yeah,
happens
that's why there's
where
so many that are so close.
Literally
So
I gotta
close.
get, I know, and I feel terrible because I have David's custom taker bust.
That
I did a
was
Undertaker.
about a year ago when you finished it up, actually.
Yeah, I
It was
know,
ready
and
to
I,
mold.
yep, so I got this Undertaker bust that I've did for my buddy David for his birthday, which was a surprise. So I'd been sculpting on this thing for,
Well, yeah, it was over a year because
a year,
it
2 years
2 years
ago.
ago
Yeah.
when you started that,
Yeah.
but I didn't know about it till a year ago.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But it looks amazing,
Yeah.
and I bet it has more hair under that hood than Taker it does now, sadly.
Yeah, this was a fun sculpt, because normally I don't necessarily like to do caricatures or sculpts of, unless it's like a comic book where I can say, yeah, that's my take on it, kind of a deal. But yeah, this one was special to me because I was making it for my buddy, and so I wanted to nail this. And there's so many variations of Taker in general, that can be done. Let's see if we can go to the wide camera. Maybe we can get a little better view of him. Boosh. But so to me, it was definitely important. I liked the hooded taker, so yeah. I am do need to finish this, and I am gonna finish this. I
But he's got to
swear.
mold it,
I know
so
that it's
it's.
ready to mold, and so we
We could
just.
probably, when we do this rhino, we can do it alternating layers. That
Yeah.
gives us something to do
Yeah.
between drying layers on the rhino,
Yep. So
because we'll be
there's.
using the same materials.
Yep. So there's
Yeah.
a taker one. Oh, and then this one.
Yeah.
This one I've got to get this one finished.
Yep.
This is my toxic meltdown Jason bust. I've been wanting to get this sucker finished. It's been done. I just have to mold it, and so it's like, it's just a matter of all these things to do, being one guy, and if David's not around, then I'm not necessarily able to jump in there and get to get everything done like I'd like
Yeah,
to, and
it's possible. It's a lot harder without
oh yeah.
assistance. So
Yep.
having the two of us together, we can get stuff molded
Yeah,
pretty
oh yeah.
good. Measuring stuff out and just the two of us brushing on at the same time helps get it done.
Yep.
It's always a good thing.
Yeah. And you can also see here too, there's that finish line I was talking about. So this is going to be a slush cast. And then, this stuff doesn't matter. Even if I molded it with
Yeah.
all of this junk
It
here
gets churned
unsmoothed,
away after
yeah,
it's
it'll get all
cast.
ground out. So, but yeah, this piece I think turned out really nice. I'm really happy with it. And it, like I said, it's done. All I have to do, and there's that teeth thing I was talking about where everything has to be, all those teeth have to line up and match, and there's a cuspid and a bicuspid,
I'm such even as small as it is on there, they make sense.
It's accurate. Absolutely. So anyway, that guy's coming soon too. So I've got about three busts four, because I finished up that rubberneck one too.
Yep. That one's right. That was on the stream a while ago.
Yep, I did that rubberneck one on the stream. So.
And that big one, I always forget what you call that big one.
Night Terror.
Night Terror. Yeah.
Yeah, the big one up there.
That Night one Terror. Has the coolest teeth, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, he's. I'm gonna pull him down just because he's fun to look at too.
And it has a very Evil Dead kind of a feel to it.
Oh yeah.
And I think that's another reason I like it. But it's also huge. But the details are great. I mean, that's one that I think will be a favorite once it's ready.
Yeah.
People are gonna just love that.
And like I said, I think this one is just about done too.
Yeah.
Like I've got the cleanup lines here. I got to clean up.
Yep.
Maybe a little, a couple cleanups on the teeth, but of course, centrals, laterals, cuspids, bicuspids, molars. I mean, the whole thing is all there. And I'm going to go to the wide cam because this sucker is, I mean, this is about the same size as the Nosferatu, I dare say.
Yep.
But
this one will actually be that size when it's cast.
Yeah.
Because with Nosferatu, you're going to trim his lapels a little. So.
Yeah, you can see there's the finish line. So. Yeah, but
this is one I'm really excited to see done because it's so cool.
Folks, we are so stinking close to getting new product.
Tiles of new product.
I know, man. We've got so much going on here.
It's just literally there's, just considering the time we have to work on molding is weekends.
Yep.
There's many, many weekends worth of molding.
Yeah. Yep. But
that
and
guy
then
is awesome.
Pickle Boy. Mm-hmm. Why I called him Pickle Boy, I'm not sure yet, but... yeah, he's the story behind that is there's actually people out there that have this disease where their lip and everything is
it's not even there.
Yeah, it's all just kind of blended in together, and I loved the cauliflower ear. So I thought, I'm just gonna leave a cauliflower ear on this little mutant. So he's pretty fun too. He's a good sized piece, and you can see this one is actually really dominant. You can really see where that finish line is gonna go.
Yep.
So once you start molding that sucker up, you'll see there's the finish line, and then it'll just pour it directly in. So we're close, man. There's so many things I've gotta get done.
Yeah, this one again. This is another one that is going to be an amazing seller, I think,
because
it's such a unique character, and I like how it incorporates the base.
Yeah.
And then again, the teeth in there are ridiculous, as tiny as they are. The details in that mouth is just amazing.
My camera just isn't quite out of range.
Tall.
Yeah, he's just too tall. But yeah, this one's fun too because he's kind of just this worm beast, kind of deal. So
almost like the Thing, a mutation of the Thing, the John Carpenter movie.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway,
kind of a beast out of that type of a world.
Whoops! And I just kicked my camera. We're going crazy. We're going crazy here.
Realign it back here.
Yeah, realign us. Realign us.
There you go. Oh, microphone's too much in the way there.
Yeah. Now we're way off. Go. Okay, yeah. So anyway, let's get back to these crazy shenanigans here. Working on this rhino bust. Let's see. Okay, so Hound Cave says, so is there a collection purchase model for all of the ones you have shown? And I'm assuming that you mean that you can just purchase. I'm assuming. The ones that are up on the shelves that are still in the clay mold form, or in the clay form, no, not yet. I'm going to get those eventually molded, and then I will do them. But my website has, pretty much everything that you see up in the past works that's cycling through. All of those are for sale. And, collection purchase model.
Well, that's kind of like I think what we talked about before, where you had talked about creating a series, so you'd have several different pieces that fall under, like the things in jars. It's
oddities and sculpts,
which would be kind of a neat thing. And even like that first the big zombie, we had even talked about doing several zombies of the same exact size, shape, but just different faces, different damage, and make them as kind of a collectible series. And technically, you have like the clowns.
Yeah.
All those.
I've got like three
clowns that all kind of fit in the same size and shape that you could actually do as a collector's
series. A series, yes, absolutely. I do. I've got You know, I've got clowns, I've got mutants, I've got things in jars, because I do actually have quite a few things in jars. You know, I've got little shrunken heads that I've actually just started adding. I have, that's brand new too, that's going to be going to the show. So I'm going to be doing that and getting those done. And I've got quite a few more that I'm working on, shrunken head size. There's just, what really stinks is the fact that I'm just one guy. I'm one guy, and I work a full-time plus job, and it just absolutely destroys any and all energies. I mean, I'm all passionate about it when I'm at work, and then when I get home, you know, I'm just dragging, you know, and that's even after 2 5-hour energies. But yeah, so I'm just one man that I eventually I'm gonna quit my day job. What do you think of that? And I'm gonna be a full-time sculptor.
Get Wi-Fi and stream it live on Twitch when you walk in there and say, "I'm out."
That's right. I'm out.
Take this job and stuff
Yeah.
it. I ain't working here no more.
Let's see here. Hound Cave Production says, "What do you call the tall zombie creature?" It was really cool. Oh, the one with all the
That's
teeth,
right, the night terror one.
Night Terror is going to be what it's going to be called. And I mentioned this in another stream. I mentioned this in another stream, and I think it's important to talk about this little guy, because he's so stinking close too. He's got a little more work to go. But this guy, I actually have seen in my dreams twice. And I mentioned it, like I said, in the last one, so I won't cover too much about it. You can always go back and watch one of the other streams that talks about this. But this guy I've actually seen in my dreams twice. One was a male and one was a female. And it was really disturbing, because it was one of those dreams where it was just like so real to me, and I'm kind of half awake, half asleep, and then my poor wife, God bless her, and she has to duck, because man, I'll come up swinging, you know, like literally like swinging and kicking my feet trying to get these creature, you know, this creature away from me. So, but yeah, this creature, a male and a female version, and it was really disturbing. So I thought, ah, why, good therapy. I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna do a sculpt of it. And so, and then there you go. So that's what how that works out.
And that one
But
has such a cool pose too.
yeah.
'Cause like the others, it's a head and a neck, but it has that twist to it that adds a lot of character.
Yeah. One of the things too that I love to do on my sculpts here, and I don't know how well this is gonna pick this up, but I like to give that separation, like right as in the profile, you can see these kind of divots. To me, that just kind of adds a little personality to the sculpt itself. You know, little areas that dig come up, and I just like that little imperfection of these little grooves and ruts. It just gives some depth. So I saw that and I thought I would talk about that real quick. Kind of fun.
And Sarah says, "Now it's going to come to life."
Yeah, boy, that hurts.
I don't know. I kind of feel like it's containing whatever it is that you saw. It's kind of containing that energy or something. Because it goes back to like Wes Craven's New Nightmare, where he talks about how the movies contained the evil force of Freddy, and then because there hadn't been movies that he was unleashed. And so I think sometimes artwork can contain that energy.
So Travis the Overlord, he just made an interesting comment that just took me back in time. He says he also says in his sleep, "I'm Batman." Now, this is funny because, you know, I am a big Batman freak. I mean, as you can see, I've got the bat suit, which is awesome, and I'm even going back into when I was, you know, a kid, a young kid. I would make my own bat suits out of, you know, duct tape, and I was Batman. That's just the way it was. I was Batman. Make no mistake about that. But anyway, Travis is my brother, by the way. Travis the Overlord, that's my brother. And so he's put up with me, you know, his whole life. But anyway, my brother Travis and my friend Chris, I think, were staying the night, and we were all in one room. And anyway, I was asleep, and then I think I sat up, or I mumbled something, and either Travis said or Chris said, help me out, Travis, on that if you can remember. But somebody, one of them, I mumbled something, and Travis said, "What did you just say?" And I said, "I'm Batman." And I mean, I meant it. I was serious. Even in my sleep, I was out, and they're laughing, but I was serious. I mean, I was Batman in my sleep, so that's just the way it was. So thank you for bringing that back up to me. And Travis says we tapped our heads. Oh, taped our heads with cheesecloth to make the masks, cutting it off some took of the hair. Yeah, because we would
for
make
doing duct tape.
Yeah, we would duct tape masks and we would put cheesecloth over it and duct tape it. And yeah, those were the days, man. Those were the days. Some awesome masks. We used to make, you know, backyard wrestling, you know.
Yep.
And that was our gimmick, was we would make these masks. And of course, you know, there was only three of us. Chris asked, what did I say? And then I said, I'm Batman. Oh. But anyway, yeah, there was only three or four of us in our little wrestling league, but when you can make masks, you've got an infinite army of wrestlers. So we had so many masked wrestlers, it was great. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of fun back then. I remember, you know, I'd be wrestling my buddy, and then I would bribe Travis. I'd say, you know, Travis, listen. I'd go to him in private, you know, afterwards, and I right before the match, and be like, Travis, listen, I need you to be the referee for tonight's match. And Travis would be like, oh, I don't want to do it. And I'd be like, Travis, listen, I know you've been eyeballing my skateboard. I know you've been eyeballing it. So here's what's going to happen. When I go for the pin, you just make a fast count, 1, 2, 3. I win the match and you get the skateboard, okay?
Nice.
It was awesome. And Travis took it once in a while. Yeah. Once in a while he would say no, but it just depended. And I had to keep upping things. I was like giving bikes away and...
I'm going to have to get Jack Tunney to investigate.
Yeah, Jack Tunney, the president of the WWF. But yeah, Travis was on the take. All for a cardboard title. You believe that?
It's all about building value.
Yeah, I lost a world, you know, my bicycle over a cardboard title, but I won the match. So that's what's important. But yeah. Who's your favorite idiot? It's me.
Southern heavyweight wrestling champion of the world.
Absolutely. Hey, I carried that title with pride, man. Yep. Hulk Hogan himself couldn't beat me.
Well, you just got lucky the Iron Sheik decided to put you over that night.
yeah, he did.
And not break your back.
Yeah, make a humble. No, those were days, man. Those were the good old days.
Now we just wrestle digitally.
Yeah, now we wrestle digitally. Which technically there's a referee mode, and I could still have Travis come up and cheat.
Yep.
So there you go. There you go. Yeah, holding that cardboard belt was an honor. Well, it was an honor to have you hold that title, Travis. So
for the brief moments of holding it up to show the world who won.
Yeah. Well, I got to admit, I'm only going to admit this once. So, Travis, you better hit record or something. But there was a lot of times that Travis put up with my shenanigans, and I'm very thankful. So, Sarah, thank you so much for the stream. You're awesome. Thank you for tuning in and watching. I appreciate it. Thank you for hanging in here with us and putting up with our shenanigans. So, you've been awesome, and I appreciate it. And I hope you come back. Please come back, and don't be a stranger. I enjoyed having you in here tonight, so thank you so much. But enjoy your evening, as they say. So, G-night.
Always fun to have interactive chatters, too.
Oh, absolutely.
Throwing out questions and having a conversation.
Oh, absolutely.
Makes
it's awesome.
Time go really fast.
Oh, yeah. What are we up to right now?
We're already at 7:20.
7:20?
Yep.
7 minutes and 20 seconds?
No.
What is that?
Almost 7:30.
Oh, wow. Well, how many hours is that? Where are we at?
About an hour. Just under an hour and a half. So not a long time, but I know you have work tomorrow, too.
Yeah, that sucks. Mm-hmm. But, it is what it is.
Yep.
Can't believe I actually got the time to get it off today. So,
yeah,
I had a good birthday today. That was fun. Good. So just deepening in some of these ruts and these grooves. And going back to that glove mold, that's one of the things I wanted to talk about, that glove mold where you brush on the silicone, which we will do streams of those, I promise, mm-hmm. everybody. Thank you so much for hanging in there with us. But those are interesting in themselves because you end up, you know, one layer takes 45 minutes in between each layer. Mm-hmm. So you put your first layer on, and then you have to wait 45 minutes, and then you put your second layer on, and then so on and so forth for like four or five layers. So it's going to be a longer stream, but it's going to be pretty cool for everybody to see the progress as it happens. So,
and we can mold up more than one piece too. So after one layer is done, mix up another batch to the next layer.
Yeah.
And then that usually will balance out pretty close to the 45 minutes.
Yeah.
With all the measuring and stuff going on, plus the chatting and all that kind of stuff too.
Travis the Overlord asks, did David get his Ocular Rift? He's guessing no.
You're right. I did not get that yet, and I guess I shouldn't feel too bad because almost nobody else has either. Ship date was supposed to be Monday, and then they said Monday, like the night before, that, oh yeah, they'll go out Wednesday. And so far, only two people have reported getting a ship confirmation. So I will not get it till next week.
Which really sucks, because we were hoping that he would have gotten it last
locked
night.
Locked into virtual reality all day today, brother.
The Toby Wayne Show would not have been happening today if he would have gotten his Oculus Rift, brother.
We would have been riding virtual roller coasters and wandering the wastelands of Fallout.
Yeah, no kidding. No kidding.
In full 360.
Yes. Yes, clean slate, it's true. I had a birthday today, so thank you very much for that birthday wish. I appreciate it very much. I turn all of 25 today, so shut up.
25 years young.
Yeah, 25 years young mentally, that is. So, yes, good times. I had a fantastic birthday dinner last night. I went to a spaghetti warehouse and had spaghetti. And then
lasagna.
Yeah, lasagna. And then we came back here and played video games, as Hank Hill would say, video games. Video games. I'll tell you what. Thank you, Hound Cave. You know, it's funny. Every time I see Hound Cave Productions, I want to say Horror Cave Productions.
Not a bad name.
Yeah, it's a great name. I now dub you Horror Cave.
Pretty close to my horror face.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, David
has revived.
I know you do.
I looked on my Facebook page and it's been like years since I posted anything on there, but I still get likes and stuff. Which
Is
like,
yeah,
probably
cool.
Should turn it into something.
Yeah, yeah. yes, 25, more like 13. Mentally, yes. I'm definitely a youngster at heart, so that's what keeps me looking so nice, so healthy, so vibrant. That and all the 5-hour energies I take. But no, today, this morning, I went out with my beautiful bride, Katie, who actually also moderates on here. She's she's a hoot and a holler to have on the show. I've got a stream where she's on there, and we had a good time. That was her first stream in. So, but yeah, we went out shooting this morning, and I did really good. I think I did pretty good. If it was an intruder, I would have punched a hole through him the size of Texas. That's right. And I would have too. I would have. And it was awesome. I enjoyed it. So, and I ran up, and once I got done shooting it, I ran up and maced it.
The dead target.
Yeah, it was just a target, a piece of paper. But it had a hole in the size of Texas, and it was maced before it was over. But,
and in fact, it was the shape of Texas.
Yeah, it was. It was. But so that was a lot of fun. And then we came back here and I watched David play
Fallout 4.
So,
which is great. Yeah. I literally started playing it like last weekend when I downloaded it.
Yeah.
Just a little bit, and then mostly last night.
Yep.
I think I got 10 hours into it over the last 3 days that we played it.
I felt really bad because I'm up at 4 a.m. and, you know, normally, and so you can imagine my schedule, my mind, and my body is set for 4 a.m. and, you know, I slept in the chair a little bit.
A little bit.
You know, a lot, but still, I was there. And anyway, yeah, it was like 5 a.m. when you turned everything off. And then David, you know, went to the guest room. And then I went back and fell asleep and then got up at 9:30 or whatever it was. And so it was fun.
I ended up watching, what did I watch? Better Call Saul and something else. I turned on thinking I'd just fall asleep to it, and then I ended up watching because it was good.
Wow.
So it was closer to like 7:30, I think, when I actually fell asleep.
Oh, yeah.
Or, no, 6:30.
Travis the Overlord says Toby's a natural marksman. He his first time shooting, he grouped them tight, which, you know, was awesome. Yep. Yeah, I felt good. I've always been a machete and blunt weapons guy. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what I always just defended the house with. Yeah. If I ever had any issues, I thought, well, I'm just going to cut the guy's head off when he comes in, you know? But
like, this is where he's.
Kill him, Toby. Kill him. And don't think I wouldn't either. But that was fun. We went out shooting. Travis went shooting with me the first time I ever fired my handgun, which was December. I've only shot it a handful of times. Yeah. I wish I had an image of it. Actually, I do. I don't know if I can.
I don't know if you're supposed to show it on Twitch.
You don't think so?
I don't think so.
No gun
ammo?
Some,
Yeah, there was some comment the other day. A guy had a toy gun on, and somebody made a comment that make sure you have that little orange tip on there.
Oh.
So I think they were, there's something.
Well, this was just that. My target. I was just going
to
show.
Oh, the target. Yeah,
yeah,
you chose
I was just
going to
show the target.
Yeah, they probably can't show the gun. We'll have to read the fine print just to be sure.
Yeah.
It's one of those things like.
Let's not offend anybody.
No male nipples either.
Yeah.
As much as you all want
to
see
I know.
That.
And dang it.
Twitch won't allow it.
I know. I had to fight to keep my shirt on, I guess.
But yeah, you can show the target, which is really cool because it's that marker target. So it has like those nice bright colors that crackle out when you shoot it.
Yeah. Let me see if I can pull it up here.
Ammo boxes. I think you can show ammo boxes.
Oh, I forgot to send Travis the photos, so maybe that's why I'm not sending stuff. Duh. Do ammo boxes count?
As long as they're empty.
Yeah, as long as they're empty.
You probably went through quite a few though today.
Not too much. Mm. I think maybe a box and a half, maybe. Something like two boxes maybe. I don't know. I blow through them pretty darn quick. So
someday I want to do that. Do they have like rentals out there where you can rent? Like they have guns on site you can rent just for shooting, or do you have to bring?
No, I think you. I think you. I don't know.
Because I know some places do have like rentals of different handguns and rifles.
Yeah, there's my targets, and that was at 25 feet away, so
yeah.
that's not too shabby, right?
Pretty good.
Yeah, pretty good. Pretty good groupings, I dare say. I was shooting a little low on that top right one, though, for some reason. But, yeah, that dead center one at 25 feet, that's pretty good. I was pretty happy with myself. And I'm still learning on doing that cool little finger twirl thing, you know, where you put your gun on there and spin it around.
Yeah.
Boy, they get upset when you do that there.
Yeah. Unless you're RoboCop, it's probably not a good idea.
No, I'm TobyCop.
Yeah, TobyCop.
Thank you, creep. Drop it. So that was a lot of fun, and had a good time there, and I appreciate Katie taking me out shooting, so that was fun. Gonna do more of that soon.
And we had some hasty freeze
for lunch. Nice little greasy spoon burger place, old school burgers.
Good, actually I was impressed with it.
Drop it, Hound Cave. Dead or alive, you're coming with me. It's probably the worst TobyCop impression of all time.
Not bad though, really.
Yeah, well, I'll go with it. David's a massive RoboCop fan.
I love RoboCop.
I never got into it as much as he did. In fact, I still have your copy of RoboCop on the shelf.
You do? Well, I have it on Blu-ray three times.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah.
I bought the trilogy, then I bought the individual one. They just re-released another version, just cleaned up. And then the newer movie, which is okay for what it is, but it's still not the classic.
No.
It's nowhere near as violent and bloody either.
Yeah.
But that's why I think we watched the Blu-ray.
We did.
But I don't remember
if you were watching it
all the way through or not. But
Is that your way of saying I was asleep?
Well, I don't remember. I think it was during the afternoon one day, but I think you were busy sculpting or doing something else. But there is such violence in there when they're blasting, you know, Murphy into pieces at the beginning, that even as a kid I didn't remember, because a lot of times I saw it was on TV.
Well, they had the edited.
Yeah, it was the KPTV 12 edited version for the Saturday afternoon.
Yeah.
And so it didn't show as much of that, but like when he blasts his hand off, it goes flying into little bits and chunks, and it's actually quite violent.
Yeah, well, that's, yeah, and that's what Hound Cave is saying too.
It's such a great movie. I mean, I love it. The sequel's not so much, even though I do like RoboCop 2, because there's a scene where he walks through an arcade, and the arcade is filled with Data East machines, because Data East had the license to make the RoboCop arcade game.
Oh, yeah.
So you see bad dudes in there, and I think there's even a Karnov at one point, but they're all the same Data East cabinets, and there's a Ghostbusters in there, the three-player Ghostbusters. So I like watching that, because it's total destruction of this 80s arcade.
That's awesome.
And the evil guy in the second, it's technically the RoboCop 2, is the evil guy that they put in there and use his brain.
Yeah.
For, you know, that nuke drug or whatever.
Yep.
And they did a pretty good job on the sequel.
Yeah.
But it's not as good as the first, and the third is pretty garbage.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. The remake, I feel the same way. I think for what it was, if that was the only movie, if there was no original RoboCop, it would have been great. And I did kind of like the personality and the emotion that they built into it, but the suit was awful.
Yeah.
It looks so awful. That bare hand didn't make any sense.
Yeah.
I mean, they explain it by saying, well, you know, that's his trigger hand, and that's the only other part of him that was salvageable. But why? When you can have a nice robotic hand You don't need to have like a plain looking man's hand when the rest of his entire body is a robot.
Yeah, why don't you just paint his fingernails while you're at it?
Yeah, it was dumb. It made no sense. It looked unfinished.
Yeah.
It didn't make any sense. And they never truly explained it. They just kind of like assumed it's because that's all that remained of him.
Yeah.
But why? Why keep it?
I don't know. I'm not sure, and I don't really know why, no. But it is
the
what
best
it
part
is.
Of that movie. I think was Michael Keaton playing the evil CEO. He was amazing in that movie.
Didn't even yeah. realize he was in it.
Yeah, he was really good in that movie.
Yeah.
And who else did they have in there? They didn't have Peter Weller. I was thinking, you know, because he was in the Star Trek movie. I, mm-hmm. I remember seeing him recently, and he played a bad guy. That was in the second Star Trek.
Yeah.
But he also did the voice of Batman in the Dark Knight animated movie, which was really good, but I kept hearing RoboCop's voice.
Yeah, so
and
that's
so it took
weird.
Me about 15 to 20 minutes to start thinking of him as a Batman. And yeah. when I did, then it worked. He actually did a pretty good job, but his voice is so iconic to RoboCop, even without the little robotic kind
yeah.
of effects they add, that at first I was like, man, Batman sounds like too much like RoboCop.
Yep. Yeah, them are the breaks, I suppose.
Yep.
You know, it is what it is, so.
Yeah. They mentioned you didn't like how they kept him alive and making RoboCop not have an internal fight of being alive or a machine. Yeah, they had that moment that I thought was cool when they take him apart and they show him as just a head and a gut sack, and he has that tear when he cries, and he's like, never show me that again, never let my family see that.
Yeah.
I thought that was a pretty cool moment, but they basically control him. They turn him off, and then he's under their full control.
Yeah.
So I think there was good moments, but it still can't live up to the first one.
Yeah.
The first movie still is relevant. All the political satire that was built in is still relevant today. And I think that's the coolest thing about that.
Mm-hmm.
They tried it in the new movie, and they did a pretty decent job considering the modern day time. But
yeah.
Yeah, love RoboCop.
Yeah, I just couldn't get into it as much as, you know, I had him on my wall as a kid, you know, but I just couldn't. I just wasn't as interested in RoboCop, but it was what it was, I suppose.
Maybe I'll stream the arcade game. Probably not tonight because it's in the back corner, but I do want to stream that game sometime soon, too. Because that's one where most people only remember the first level, because that's about
all, that's all you could get,
you can get on a single quarter.
Sure.
And even as a kid when I played it, I maybe played you know, a dollar's worth and get through the second level at best.
Yep.
But I think I've only played through all the way maybe two or three times.
Yeah.
And that's only because I have free play now.
Yeah.
So you got a question about what technique did you use to make the horn damage?
Oh, yes. Very, very good question, Hound Cave. I appreciate that. So, you know, as a sculptor, you know, I'm always thinking of ways to incorporate texture. And I've always been such a detail freak. So I'm always looking around at things that create texture. And I mean, I've used everything from orange peels to branches to
leather.
Hey,
don't you want a balloon?
Thank you for the follow. Hopefully I didn't butcher that name. Thank you very much. I appreciate that follow. We're working on a Rhino bus today. Hopefully I'll get this sucker done because it weighs... a ton.
Yep.
So thank you very much. I appreciate the follow and thank you for the compliment. But as a sculptor, I'm always looking at things. And so the horn, I actually used a rock. Let me see if I can find my, oh yeah, there I am. There's my rock. So I use a variety of rocks. And actually, if you'll notice, or maybe you won't notice, there's a lot of texture on these bumps and all that good stuff. Let me jump to my widescreen here. Maybe that'll help out a little bit, or maybe not. But anyway, there's a lot of little bumps and textures on them, and that's just basically rock. Like I'll soften the clay up and just press in, or all, these are pressed in and these are added. So the positive bumps, I will add a little clay and then press it in, and it'll make a texture. So that horn, that battle damaged area there on the horn. I just took a rock, and all the rocks have different textures. This one's actually kind of full because it's got, you can see some of the clay residue.
There's clay inside the pits.
Yeah, but the sharper the rock, you know, the better you'll get. So if I just gently, you know, push that in, it'll actually put a dent inside of there. And so your rock and stuff and your texture, depending on what you're using, is going to leave a whole different variety of textures and damaged marks and all that good stuff. So excellent question. I appreciate that. Thank you so much for that. Always fun to talk about that kind of stuff. And then also I talked a little bit about these sponges. If you you can go about this a couple of different ways. You can actually take this sponge and you can lay on your lighter fluid, because a lot of people ask me, well, what are you painting on there? And it's lighter fluid, so whatever you do, you know, do not use around open flame when you're working on this, because this stuff will go up. But anyway, yeah, so I use lighter fluid because that stuff really softens up the clay and corrodes it and really eats it down, and you can blend it up using brushes. But so you can do the sculpt that way and then just gently dab it on, and then that'll knock that lighter fluid off, and it leaves an excellent texture as well. The camera's not going to pick it up because it's so minute, so tiny of a detail, but when you see it up close and in person, it's pretty amazing to see that texture come through on that. But it's pretty awesome. And then you can also soak your sponge in lighter fluid and then dab it on, and then that's actually a really aggressive way to do it, because the sponge holds the liquid, but then at the same time, when you're pressing onto it, it's just drips. Yeah. And then so it's a very aggressive way to do a lot of texture and detail real quick. You just get a bigger sponge and you just dab that sucker on there, and it'll make a great— I'll just do that straight up for pores on faces and stuff, you know. So it's pretty cool the way that stuff works. So but yeah, we get pretty creative as artists for texture. I one time I actually was sitting in traffic and I noticed the steering wheel had a fantastic texture to it, like the leather that they'd gotten wet or whatever, and then stretched it out, and it had these great patches of texture, like wrinkles and stuff. And I just thought, man, that's fantastic. So I came home and mixed up some silicone and brushed it on there and let it cure, you know, for the couple hours, and then peeled it back, and I made my own texture stamp. So it's pretty cool textures all around us.
Yeah, a lot of it is finding good reference photos and then just trying to replicate that. So oftentimes with like leather textures, it's drawing the shapes with your point tool, you know, dragging that through and then softening those edges up, and you get those nice kind of variations, like the back of the neck hair where it kind of crosses over a little bit. That kind of stuff reminds me a lot of like the creases on the edges of leather where it folds.
And that's exactly what it looked like. But one time I found an orange at the Hobby Lobby, or a lemon. It was a plastic lemon, and it just had the coolest texture. And so I thought, so I went and bought it and then brought it back. And, you know, those are your kind of limited, because it's round, you have to kind of try to roll it a little bit. And it can be a challenge if you're, you know, if you're not thinking about or trying to get into tight areas. But the sponges are great,
because with those plastic things like that, even Dremel a piece of it out, so you have like an easier piece you can put your thumb in but just make your own little tool customized from that.
Or just take the lemon and do a brush on mold peels right off. And then you
if you have latex available, you can always do the same thing with latex.
That's true.
Although if you're going to be molding with silicone, you don't want the latex to be touching your clay. So if you're brushing something on, silicone's the best way if you're going to plan to mold it. But the older days, when it was really sculpting for plaster molds, you could use latex left and right for textures, and that was actually a big thing to do. We did that latex hole in different textures that you could let dry and peel back and pop stuff out and get amazing texture.
Yeah.
And latex can work pretty fast that way too.
Yeah. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Pretty versatile stuff. Mm-hmm. You know?
If you do use latex as a tool, you've got to seal the sculpt before you mold it.
Yeah.
And that can also alter your texture.
Yep. The chemicals are not good for the silicone. Yep.
Yeah, natural latex will inhibit your silicone.
Yeah.
Which is not fun.
Yeah. Clean slate, if you're still here on the feed, I was curious, do you ever mold up any of your stuff, like any of your parts that you— what he'll do is he'll tear a figure apart, like an action figure, and then he'll rework it, and he does modifications. So I was just curious if you ever broke— when your pieces are apart, if you mold up individual pieces and use them, because I know you can do, you can cast up ball and socket joints and then, you know, rework, you know, redo it and make custom hands and stuff. So I was just curious if you're still on the stream and you hear this question, I'm curious if you, if you ever do any molds.
I know there's a lot of people that do the six scale figures, and they'll take like the head of like a sideshow figure and pop it off.
Yeah.
And then they'll re-sculpt their own head and then make molds of that. So they'll sell the heads to other collectors.
Oh,
just
yeah.
Want to pop a new head onto the body that they already have.
That's slick.
And so I know there is a market for people that do customized body parts, like the alternate hands that they come with. You can make new hands and pop those on. They're a little more difficult to do than a head, but I've seen some heads that actually have actual herring done, like the Joker from Sideshow had sculpted hair. So people have actually recreated that head really well, better paint job than Sideshow did, and with real hair.
Oh,
it looks amazing.
Cool.
But the head alone can be anywhere from $300 to $500.
Isn't that ridiculous?
Yeah, because the action figure itself is like $300 to $500, and the head, a custom head that looks that good, can easily go for $300 to $500.
I see Clean Slate says not yet. Definitely want to try.
Cool.
I would definitely encourage you to learn to do the molding and casting if you're familiar with it at all. It's just kind of comes in handy. I was thinking for your, you know, your hobby of getting in there and, you know, producing and, you know, making custom sculpts and stuff, you know.
Especially if you want to make more than one to sell.
Well,
that's
what
comes in really handy. Because the one-offs you can do, but then you have to do the same work every time.
Yeah.
Whereas a mold, it adds more work at the beginning, but...
That sounds like our cat's getting ready to throw up.
She's going to puke.
She's going to puke.
You're sick, huh?
Yeah, you're
sick. Sick. You're going to puke?
Hey, you going to puke? That's a WWE event.
She's gonna puke.
And I'm so glad that she decided to throw up right on the carpet. She couldn't go outside. She couldn't. So watch yourself when you go around that corner.
She just ate too. Good thing we don't have live streaming smell-o-vision.
Ugh, good lord. Yeah. So Clean Slate says it just seems so complicated, and in reality, it's not. It's actually...
It's a little intimidating.
It's intimidating, but it's not complicated. Right. Like, if you have your part and you know what you're wanting... In fact, let me see if I've got my sculpt up here, because I think I even did. I was just looking at this the other day, and I don't know if I've got the mold for it. I had it... Oh, yeah. No? It's here somewhere. I don't have the mold for it. I'm not sure where it went to, and I really wish I do have it, but... Huh. Well, anywho... So here's a couple of casts that I did, and they're going to be really hard to see, because this one's black onyx, of course, and then this is a, you know, a smooth cast, what, I think 320. 300, I think, has the pure white, and this is a 320, which I actually prefer the 320 over white, but they, for some reason, they don't seem to have that. Oh, it looks like Hound Cave is splitting. Thank you so much for that follow, Hound Cave. You know, make sure if you've got an Instagram or you, especially YouTube, because I do transfer these back out to you for my YouTube channel for content. But thank you so much for the follow. Thank you so much for coming in tonight and hanging with us. Had a good time. Thank you. Tell your in-laws, outlaws, you know, spread the word. So you're awesome. I appreciate you. So, so anyway, these are just, you know, castings. I did a sculpt, you know, and made a mold of it and cast it, you know, and, you know, you could probably even sculpt the ball and socket in, I'm assuming. I haven't really looked, too much at it.
Doing that requires a two-part mold.
So yeah.
Even though you have a glove around it, you've got to have a core to make the negative shape that fits perfectly to your piece.
Yeah.
So there, it's a little more complex for that.
Yeah.
But it can be done.
Yep.
And depending on how it's customized, that may be something you can easily drill into it and modify.
Yeah. And Hound Cave says he's going to check out that pinball as
very
well.
Cool.
So
yeah.
David Batman 1980s.
Got some great video on demand streams there from the last week or so with WrestleFest and WrestleMania pinball and
a
whole variety of things. So.
Cool stuff for sure.
We'll do some more next week.
Oh, yeah.
I'll do a new stream next week sometime.
Yeah, it's cool. So thank you so much for tuning in. But Clean Slate, it just is a little intimidating at first, because trust me, I'm one of the most intimidated guys around when it comes to certain things. And, you know, I was able to figure it out, and I'm sure you can too. It's just
it helps
a matter
to
of
have a buddy who's right there,
and
to,
it does help. Well, you know,
show
it's,
you techniques.
Well, you know, it's funny though, because when I first started molding, yeah. You weren't around, and I did most of my stuff. David came in later on, and he had, you know, even better ideas and stuff on how to do the molding and stuff, which we did the glove molds, which turned out really nice, you know, because I was just doing block molds before, you know, I was even unaware of glove molds and the such. So I'm very thankful for that. But yeah, maybe that'll be a fun little stream we can do too, where we just do a small molding, you know, block mold or whatever, two-part block mold.
And we had talked about that too, doing a very tiny sculpt, like even a magnet. Start from the base clay, sculpt it up, mold it, cast it, do all the way from beginning to end in a single stream.
Yeah.
So that would be another like all day Saturday stream.
Yeah, absolutely.
But to do a very small one and not also caring whether it turns out perfect or not. You know, you can get a really nice sculpt done in about an hour and a half or so.
Yeah.
And we can go through that base mold process for a magnet, which would be a really simple process to show.
Oh,
but we could also cast one up by the end of the stream.
Yep. That'd be awesome.
I think it'd be really cool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Clean slate. Quick question. Where are you located? If you don't mind me asking. If you don't want to, you can whisper it to David or something like that. If you don't want to talk about it. But just curious. You know, as to where everybody's from, where they're at, where they're living life.
You have guests come out here to the studio often.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I've always. In fact, that's. One of the things I love to do is have people in here all the time, you know, being right here with me the whole time. And I've had people all the way, you know, 5-6 hours away.
Yeah.
They'll come, you know, come from all over.
Yep.
Come and hang out, you know, we have a good time. So their bodies are never found later on. But,
we'll mention that they don't get back home.
But. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, Orange County, California. Yeah, dude. Serious. Cool. Serious. You know, of course, I'm in Oregon, you know, so that's, you know, Orange County, how far away is that?
It's pretty close to, that's where my family lives down in Southern California, in that area. So I would say it's, what, 12 hours? Or
12 hours. A 12-hour trip.
Yeah.
You could make that.
You could do it. My brother drove it in one go without actually getting out of the car besides a couple bathroom breaks.
Yeah.
And that's too much. I like to stay overnight somewhere.
Yeah.
On the way down.
Well, you seem like a cool cat, you know. Katie always is like, "You're not inviting everybody, are you?" And I said, "Yes, I am." But so you know, you're a cool dude. So, and we're, you know, we all have it all in common. So, I wouldn't have a problem with you coming up for sure. I've got a guest room. Comes with a, you know, two free uses of the bathroom. So, David usually.
Speaking of which, I'm on my second one.
Yeah, he's on his second. So
I'm gonna have to hold it till I get home.
There you go. And he's my friend. So yeah, no, I'd love to have you this way. If you ever want to, you know, come this way and hang out with me for a weekend, if you think you could, you know, want to do something like that or manage, you know, come hang out with me and David in the studio here. That'd be fun. So good times. And you too could be featured on the Toby Wayne Show.
Start working on that Terror Drome arcade machine.
yeah. There's a.
That'll be our project for this little corner here.
No, you can't ban David. You can't ban him. Sorry, Travis the Overlord. Always piping up with the power. I knew the moment that I gave him moderator power, it'd go straight to his head, and he's wielding power.
How funny.
Yeah, he's a sweet kid. He's a sweet kid.
Well, I'm a moderator, and I have turbo status.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which really just means you don't have to see commercials when you watch other people's streams.
Which, boy, I'd need to get that because I am really tired of seeing the streams.
There's other benefits, too, but primarily that's the main one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. See what time are we looking at here? 7:51. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to run for about another 9 more minutes, and then I'm going to go ahead and wrap this bad mamma jamma up. It's I still have to shower and make my lunch for tomorrow, and then I got to go back to the real world. But
I wake up just a few hours later.
Yeah. It's been nice, you know. not having to go to work today. I like that. So
I just remembered, I think I have a training tomorrow, but I don't remember if I sent out the invite for it.
Uh-oh.
Which means they don't know what time they're supposed to meet me.
Yeah, there you go. That's convenient.
Yeah.
Look, if you don't want to do it, just, you know, you don't have to not send out the... So one of the things, too, I talked about earlier, and the focus on this is kind of the spits, but if you'll notice, I've been working pretty heavy on this one crease here, and I really like that separation. And I'm gonna, let's shoot to the wide camera here to maybe it'll pick it up a little easier, but I really like this separation right there, and also down there. It just has that kind of that flowing, you know, rhino skin, as we talked about earlier, and I just like that separation a lot, like with muscles, you know, and bodybuilders, you know, they have that muscle cut, that separation of the muscles, and that was always interesting to me about, you know, bodybuilders and the such, that they could focus on hitting a certain muscle. So I just enjoy getting that that skin and muscle separation. So I'm going to focus on deepening that up a little bit. But the glove mold, to go back to that, if I don't even know if I covered what I was originally going to be talking about with that, as I have gotten off on my rants. But the glove mold makes it incredibly easy, because you just brush that silicone on into all the little details, and then you're not wasting so much silicone, and it's thin. It's not a real heavy duty. It's heavy duty in the sense that it's durable. It'll work, and it's nice, but you have to be careful, because it's not 3 inches of silicone. You're dealing with, you know, a quarter of an inch, I think, is the minimum, right? Like, you know, just a quarter of an inch is recommended, but you can go a little thicker, but because it's, easier to work with.
Yeah. Too much thicker makes it a little rigid, so a quarter is pretty good when you're peeling off.
I had a bummer happen. Here was a Deadpool bust that I did. I got a 1-1 scale here, and he's really washed out. But it broke. It you know, it's thick resin too, but it fell off the top of my.
It's about 7 foot fall. Yeah, or so, 6.5 foot.
That sucked, because it's technically cement. Yeah, it's technically supposed to come down, what, to here somewhere in there. But yeah, and I even saw it when it turned on the garage door, just the top of his head
caught the top of it, hook of the,
yeah, the hood dropped there. So I was really bummed about that, but yeah, so I gotta get a new one of those poured up, and oh well. But I need to, that, but the glove mold for that Deadpool had to be done that way, because it's just too big of a piece to not have that. So glove molds are amazing. They're really cool, and you can, you know, handle them, and they actually, I think, last a little longer than block molds, because block molds, if that sucker is rigid and you're trying to pull out a piece that's, you know, rigid itself, then it's just going to tear, and you can get X amount of pores out of it, but it'll eventually start tearing it out, because it's such a you know, rigid mold. But glove molds are nice, because they have some room to give, and you can actually pull it out and away. So the glove mold for this is going to be great, especially like around in the face area and tucked up back up in there. It's not, there's not a lot, there's not a huge divot back in there, but it's enough of a lip that, you know, could cause some issues if it was a block mold. Still have a little horn work to do here, but I think we're good to go there. Yep. So that's what I know. That's, I think, we're pretty darn close. I could probably do another stream and sit here and shoot the shizit with everybody and work and cherry out some more details, but I think I'll finish this one off camera just to kind of move things along, because I do.
It's really close.
Excuse me. Yeah, it is. It is darn tootin' close. But so I think that's it. I think that's going to wrap up this edition of the Toby Wayne Show. Of course, I'm your host, Toby Wayne, alongside David, Batman 1980. I want to thank each and every single one of you that showed up, except for Travis the Overlord. And he's been an incredible pain in my glutes all my life. And so, Travis the Overlord, I appreciate you, my brother. Love you. Clean Slate Customs, thank you very much for sticking around to the end of this. If you're still here, he's probably gone. He probably left. He probably left 20 minutes ago, but yeah. That's okay. We appreciate you being there. And Mystico TV, I believe. I appreciate you a follow today. So anyway, I've thoroughly enjoyed this stream. Thank you guys so much for checking me out. And I got to get a better schedule. You know what I mean? I got to get this thing figured out of what time I'm going to be
doing this. It's all set up now, so whenever you want to set something up, it's ready to go, button press, and you're
that's
on.
That's true. Yeah. I do like my moderators. Yep. You know, I like to have that that protection around, watching the backside. Yep. So
yeah, if you let me know before you go on, I'm always available to pop on, other than the next several days. But
that's true.
During the week, David, normally I'm available.
So. David's going to WrestleMania, so he'll be out. He'll be watching Shane McMahon beat Undertaker. Tuesday. Yeah, till Tuesday. So
I'll be coming back after all the events are done.
I just want to say a quick shout out to Bryson and Riley. Hi, kids. That's my niece and nephew. You better be paying attention. You better be learning, and you better be good. Or I'm coming down there, and I'm gonna make sure that you pay attention and be good. That's how that happens. But so anyway, thank you guys so much. I appreciate you. You guys are awesome. Thank you for the follows. Please feel free to share, like, subscribe. Tell your in-laws and outlaws about me. So anyway, you guys are awesome, and I will see you guys later.